Good morning to one and all. Before formal welcome address, we start program with Vande Mataram. Thank you. A warm welcome to today's keynote speaker, Professor Sudarshanam sir, Professor Chinnaya sir, my own guru, Honorable Vice Chancellor Professor Prabhasankar Shukla sir, Northeastern Hill University, Professor Raja Reddy sir, Honorable Vice Chancellor Sri Venkateswara University Tirupati, Professor Dikshit sir, Director IQAC Northeastern Hill University, and Mipun sir, Professor Mipun, Chairperson ISTD Indian Society for Training and Development Shillong Chapter, Professor Mithali Kovar ma'am, Principal Moran College, Dr. Rajendra Prasad Bhartakur sir, Coordinator IQAC Moran College, Dr. Srutasini Gogoi madam, Head Department of Philosophy Moran College, Dr. Nagarajasri madam, Director SVU Computer Center, and noble teachers, participants, one and all, a warm welcome and good morning. I received a few calls a few months back from teachers, those who are working at universities and colleges. So some of them, they asked, I never hesitate to share the truth research. Whenever I have time, Professor Sudarshan sir from USA, wherever sir visited almost more than 20 countries and doing research with more than 40 countries researchers. So always sharing few new innovative things, being a teacher of botany, but sir, higher order skills of ICT. So then I thought it is better, why not to provide a platform to research scholars to present their paper. One of teachers asked, is there any chance to get a certificate like that? I said, sorry ma'am, I am not able to provide that type of, it is against research ethics. So this type of things, it is not good. So based on all these things, and our Honorable Vice Chancellor sir is the main, you do something for the students and scholars. Better, till date I completed 32, recently one more on research methodology, 33 courses from 10 universities around the globe, innovative things. So doctoral thesis conferences, series of 100 conferences, bridge the gap, here research gap and grow. This is the motto of a series of 100 programs. First doctoral thesis conference on social sciences, humanities and interdisciplinary research. Even though I am from science background, maths, physics, chemistry, but research is always a creation of knowledge. Maximum is solving the unsolved problems. So transformation of information, it's okay, but according to constructivist approach, no one can give any knowledge, or no one can, it is your duty to construct your own knowledge based on your previous knowledge and past experiences. There are so many theories that is different. But after initiation of Friday program, a series of 100 programs on research and publication, we came to know many research scholars. Really, they have innovative imagination, innovative power, but they are not getting a right platform because of COVID-19 pandemic. So we came forward with the help of senior professors like our from Chennai sir and Sudarshan sir. This is the second time the keynote address. So sir has even 2 PhDs, I think, in medicine related course. I read sir article. So with a few information, I requested Professor Sudarshan sir, sir, it is better what type of problems research scholars are facing, and how to think. Sir is the recipient of ICMR project at the Young Stage. So sir informed about Professor Chennai sir also. Sir taken the tuition for his relative boy, and when sir was a hostel warden. So here, why I'm sharing all these things, whatever you are doing, everything is your cyclic and a lifelong process. So there is no full stop, no end. Yesterday in Jain philosophy also, it's just like a circle. In research also, whatever you are doing, always it is a scope for improvement, scope for quality. So please don't bother about whatever you've done after today morning. After receiving call from Professor Sudarshan sir, what type of research I did, what type of topic I allotted to my research scholars. So after it is because of growth. If you have growth, you will feel like that. Otherwise, you feel, I am excellent. So nothing to say more than this. So Professor Sudarshan sir is an extraordinary teacher. I know personally, that's why I can understand. If we don't know about the person, it is very difficult. If I inform about dosa, idli, or South Indian dishes, it is not possible to someone never tasted. Once you taste, then only you can understand. In the same way, I know the fruitness of Professor Chennai sir and Professor Sudarshan sir. With this, I'm requesting Professor Chennai sir, first of all, to deliver keynote address, because we want to listen more from Sudarshan sir. Over to Professor Chennai sir.
So, respectable coordinator, a person for inspiration, a person of source for this program, Dr. Amreswar, Professor Sudarshanam Garu, Vice Chancellor Suklaji, SV University Vice Chancellor Rajareddy sir. So here, what is the need of research? What is the need of search? What is the need of knowledge? So the need of knowledge is to live right life. What do you mean by right life? Living without any conflict, living without any egoistic outlook, living following the basic laws of nature. So what is the actual stage of life? So soul entering in the body is birth. Soul staying in the body is a life. Leaving soul from the body is a death. So it may be a 50 years or 100 years or 120 years. So this is a life. Here we have different stages of life. So how to live here? Here our life is interrelated, interdependent. You are not independent. You are not dependent. You are interdependent. You are depending on the nature, you are depending on the water, air, temperature, food, people, all the things. This is a interdependence life. So here the research relating with academic sense, formal research, informal, non-formal, so interdisciplinary research on the humanities, research on the social sciences. So we have academic research methodology, we have a life research methodology. So The purpose is to know something. So here, to know something, knowledge, we need extraordinary motivation. Motivation is the most important. So know something. So what is the know? What is the purpose of knowing? We have to live here in the world with a pleasant manner. So otherwise, there is a danger. So here, we have to use all the things for our life purpose. In the academic affairs, at the stage of degree level, that is the spoon feeding courses, taking assistance with the guides and taking from teacher and preparing. After degree, post-graduation master degree. So here in the self-learning and self-preparation is the most important in the master level. So because after some time you are going to teach and you are going to give training for others. After a master degree, you have a doctor degree, doctor of philosophy. So this is a very famous degree. Throughout the world, it is a common degree in the university, doctor of philosophy. So here we have two important words, doctor and philosophy. Why are we coining the word philosophy in the all branches, in the science, humanities, social sciences, in the medicine, all the things? Because love of wisdom. What do you mean by wisdom? Wisdom means knowing exactly what it is, knowing what is right and what is wrong, what is good and what is bad. So knowing clearly the actual perception of the world. So actually, philosophy means love of truth. What do you mean by truth? Truth is what is. Truth is which is. Knowing anything without any description, without any bias, knowing exactly what it is called truth. What is the use of truth? Truth liberates, truth transforms, truth wins. If you see a dangerous snake, seeing the snake and escaping that snake is immediate. In the same manner, if you realize the truth, automatically that realization creates extraordinary change in the life. So relating with the humanities, social studies and the interdiscipline, relating with the knowledge of human beings, we have to study many things. At present, human beings develop science and technology with the highest level, but psychologically they are in the poor condition. They are not living very happily. So we need understanding about the external nature of the human being and the internal nature of the human being. For that, we have different type of research outlook. So for knowing about oneself, you need a method of research called meditation. So that is called watching. So that is free from formal education, informal education. That is only personal investigation. If you observe your thoughts, feelings, ambitions, attachments, body and mind, then you can understand very peacefully. If you understand the external world, the all branches of knowledge, the scientific outlook, the technological outlook, then that knowledge is very useful for our life. So here, understanding life is the most important thing in the external world. So at present, human beings developed scientifically and technologically with the highest level in the scientific world, but they are not following the laws of the nature. Loss of the balance. So here, relating with the doctor, a doctor is an expert. So he has a great investigation, outlook, understanding, everything. So he has a great realization relating with the life. A doctor is a one who got extraordinary knowledge, skillfulness, great understanding about the life. So a master is an expert. So an expert has a extraordinary understanding about a human life. So here relating with research, you need extraordinary investigative outlook, searching outlook, a person of great motivation and energy. So doctor of philosophy. Doctor of philosophy means a outlook of extraordinary inspiration. So here in the doctoral sense and the philosophical sense, we need extraordinary understanding. So So all human beings developed various types of techniques, investigations, know-how for purpose of good living. So in the field of medicine, human beings developed extraordinary understanding. They got a great understanding about the medicine. Now they are in a position to cure various types of diseases. In the social sciences, human beings have done great things about the human in the field of culture, civilization, understanding, arts, and everything. In the social sciences, the behavioral sciences, why human being is violent, why is not living with a peaceful manner, what is the source of life, how to live here in the life. So in the various dimensions, human beings have done the research. So here the doctoral research, doctorate, doctor of philosophy, we get various types of things. We get admission through research with NET or SLET or a different approach. Then he has to follow 2-3 years or 5 years in the full time or a part time. So the thesis writing is there, collection is there, material collection, the reporting and submission of thesis, preparation of various types of papers. So for a requirement of getting a PhD, at the same time presenting various types of papers to get a PhD. These are the some of the issues relating with the academic sense. These are there, but one way, the research is most important for knowing many things. So at present, human beings developed in many fields with the extent manner, but see we find air pollution, water pollution, sound pollution, but we are not living with a peaceful manner. We are creating wars in the world. We are not harmony with people. We are not sharing anything with the people. We are a self-centered people. We are killing, we are murdering, we are committing suicide. We are using various types of chemicals for nature destruction and the human beings. Our intelligence is not up to the mark. For that reason, for getting a doctorate and doing research, these are very important things for our survival. So now in this connection, I am appreciating Dr. Amareswar. So he has taken various types of initiatives to do research. So conduct in the academic line, in the research field, and the innovative manner. This is a good beginning for doing something and to know something, because research is a investigation and a searching method to know about the existing material outlook, material available already there. We have to find with a systematic manner on the basis of various types of method. This research also included in the search. So search means knowing something by direct perception. These are interrelated. Search and research, both are very essential. If you continue very eager manner, with authentic manner, after some time you may get a PhD. At the same time, you may get more knowledge relating with the human existence. That knowledge is very useful for peaceful living. So now I am concluding a small speech. I may enter for 4 or 5 minutes for a discussion. Then I may leave for another important work.
Okay, sir. Thank you very much, sir, for your brief keynote address and very important foundational things. Now I am allowing the participants to interact with the keynote speaker. Anyone, please. We need more interaction instead of typing or simply listening. Okay, I will ask my own scholar and your ad hoc teacher, Paramita Saha. If you have any query, please. Paramita Saha, are you there? Yeah, please.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yeah. Good morning, teachers. Sir, okay. I just want to know regarding like research work only, like say for example, we are preparing a tools and like now even I have requested sir also to verify my tools and all. So like as you have mentioned just now, like some teachers, they become self-centered. Like now I have approached more than 30 teachers, but they are not willing to like give a validation of my tools. So in that case, like what will I do? So like few teachers only, I got only 3 teachers who are willing to help me. but others they are not responding at all. So in that case,
here.
Like
okay, actually, sir, Parmita Saha, she approached for, she is going to standardize her tool. She joined her PhD under Assam University Silchar. She is actually an ad hoc teacher in our department. She approached 30 teachers, but only 4 to 5 are ready to respond, but others are not in a position to help.
So actually, here in the research means it is a self-study and self-preparation outlook. So avoid dependence on many people. Take original resources, study very well. And you have resources in the internet, in the various types of books. If you have to approach very intelligent manner. For example, you are going in a town, you want to take breakfast, but you have to observe the hotel shape condition, the hotel or something, the tea, or those who are preparing idli vada or something, you have to watch that type of things. If you enter in a provision store, if you ask idli, they won't give. Or if you enter in the sports shop, if you ask about vada, they won't give. In the same manner, you have to observe people, those who are very curious. So observation is the most important. If you want to find, you observe the suitable persons with their body language and your awareness. At the same time, you have various types of resources in the internet for standardization, for research methodology, everything is there in the internet. At present, you have to start with the self-learning, self-preparation, self-investigation. This is the most important for doing anything. So you try for with the motivation and observation. Shortly, you may get a solution for your problems.
So with the permission of the chairperson, actually, sir, in education research, because he belongs to education, standardization of tool and experts' opinions, remaining things she can do by herself. But these things she is a must to collect from the experts to get the up to saturation point, what type of suggestions they are giving. It is only the subject expert, just like a peer reviewed journal.
It is true. In this connection, I will tell because here in the Sanskrit, we have one general quotation. Dandam dasavita bhavate. If you greet people, you will get more advantages relating with the people. In the same manner, you have to start with obedience and good behavior, because teachers expect respect, good behavior, good words. If you start with a simple manner, with a right manner behavior, you have to prepare some ground before entering. So, for example, a teacher, if you are not relating with you, recently, I have observed one incident in the department. One lady from Hyderabad have come. She has to collect donations for children welfare. She has to come and she has to tell something, take permission for a very important person. But she has come at like, Mr. Dean, I want to talk to you. Will you give some check to me for children welfare? She asked. Dean said, who are you? Do you have any relation with me? So have you taken any permission from me for talking? So are you telling that you are a young person? You are a 24 years or 25 years age. I am a 55 years age person. So how to talk with other people? How you are calling my name? So you have to learn many mannerisms. So here also in the research also, taking help from experts, we have to investigate how to approach people. Because you see, in the not relating with you, I am telling the general example. So in the relating with men and women love affairs, relating with the love affairs of friends and the relatives and the lovers, at the beginning stage, they won't ask anything. At the beginning stage, they respect people. They talk very nicely about the people. After some time, they may get a positive response. After some time, both people may give each other the gifts and everything. In the same manner, approaching teacher is the most important. you have to take some guidance how to approach people, how to approach experts, what are the important principles, what are my behavior. So this may be sharing, this is not suggestion for you. So after some time, Dr. Amreswar may give some suggestions to you, because anything is possible with the right behavior, with the right talk, with the right movements. So if you talk with without having any consideration, without having any respect, without having any pre-preparation, without giving anything, so it is a very dangerous thing. At the beginning, we have to develop right relationship. Then after some time, you have to present your problem. This is some swearing.
Very nice, sir. I totally agree with you. Here, one more participant from Ghana, sir. Opuku Adusi. I think Paramita, sir, yes, rightly sir. Pointed out, it is better to approach the right person. Suppose it's here, education institution. In education institution, if I come and ask if any fertilizer or something, then it never, so in the same way, so whom you are approaching? You see the his CV, curriculum vitae, well, what is his specialization, whether he's a helping nature is there or not. Many teachers are knowledgeable, but not the collaborative or cooperation is nil. So another thing, your research, it not only by seeing your name, even your supervisor also. Sometimes supervisor name and fame also plays a major role. What type of person he or she, whether they are participating some collaborative programs or academic programs, so academic network. So this is very, very important, whether they are member in LinkedIn, Academia, ResearchGate. I have one professor, Gupta sir, in Bangalore. He is my LinkedIn friend. He is almost 68 years. I invited him for a 21-day FDB program and some other programs. Because of our social network, without meeting itself, we are collaborating, we are doing. So I give you some, maybe I call you some after Saturday. I give you my feedback also. And now, Opuku Adusi from Ghana. Do you have any queries so you can share the international from Ghana, how research is taking place? You are working and doing research. Adusi?
Sir, I don't have any queries for now.
Okay, please tell me.
Hello, sir. Yes, okay. I want to find out, in doing research, do I have to design my own skill as a student, or I will have to search for an already designed skill, then I either adopt or adapt? As a PhD student, can I design my own tool? Can I design my own questionnaire? Or I have to search for an already developed one and use it either by adopting or by adapting it?
Okay, sir, you got it, or may I get the response?
You tell me the question.
Sir, actually, Opeko Adusi is asking, the PhD in general, PhD scholars, someone they can use their own tool after developing standardization, some they can adopt. So which one is the best one? How?
See, here in any institution or any university, we have two types of research. One is without taking any guidance from any research expert or any institution, directly submitting a research thesis. That is one approach. The another approach is, it is an institutional approach, doing research under the guidance of one professor or one expert. So here, the research student has to take guidance from the research supervisor, because a research supervisor is one who has a lot of experience, is a qualified person, already has done the research on PhD or something. So the student has to take what type of topic I have taken, what are the questionnaire, What are the standard method? What type of analysis I have done? What are the actual tools we have to use from computer technology? These are the things we have to take guidance from the expert. So if you operate your research without taking any guidance, there may be errors and mistakes. For that, to avoid errors and mistakes, always taking guidance from the expert professor is the most important. Then you can do your research without any danger. So in the same manner, here also, if you go to a doctor, so if you take guidance and the prescription from the doctor, using medicines and the guidance of the doctor, we may cure our disease. In the say, or if you won't take any guidance from the doctor, if you take your own prescription, there may be a probability. It may be a cure or it may not cure. In the same manner, for doing research without taking any guidance from the expert, it may be a true or false. It may give good results or bad results. It is uncertainty. So always take guidance from the expert person. Then you will do your research very careful manner.
With the permission of Chennai, sir. Do see, whenever you are going to use any type of tool, first you see what are your objectives, what are your research questions, what is your research methodology or research design. Because a single size never fits for all. Based on your objectives, suppose some tools, now I'm using digital capabilities developed by University of Concordia, Canada, University of Canada. It is suitable for all, irrespective of geographical place. But certain things, based on place, it will change. Suppose now in India, still we are using 4G. Maybe African countries, I got through our friends and you have some network issues. So now in USA, already 5G they introduced. So now quality network, the 4G is excellent in India, but 5G excellent in the USA. Here, even though quality is excellent, but you can see the purpose. The same way, tool always better. I prefer to construct by myself. I already 5 PhD scholars done PhD under me. Fifth one is going to submit, 4 already done. Here, I always requesting all my scholars, they constructed their own schools, one or two. They used 3 tools, one tool maybe they adopted. There is no need to construct. Based on the purpose is important. Please check your purpose, whether already existing tool is fulfilling your needs or not. If it is not fulfilling, it is better go for standardization. Even yesterday also, some of the participants asked me to organize some program on standardization of tool. Already I delivered these lectures at HRDC, we will do. Thank you for asking nice question, Odyssey. Sir, actually he is from Ghana, sir.
Okay, very
teacher
nice.
And scholar.
Okay, very nice.
Any
Thank
other?
Thank you so much, sir.
Yeah, welcome, Odyssey. I think Jai Chitra, you are unmuted. Do you have any Jai Chitra from Tamil Nadu?
Okay, anybody?
Okay, any other? Any other, if you have any queries, it is better to ask Santosh Subba. I think yesterday also you are not responded. Do you have any network issue?
Yes, sir. Sir, am I audible
okay,
there?
Okay.
Good morning to Professor Chinni, sir.
Okay. Actually, your audio is not good.
Tell me.
Hello.
You are not audible nicely.
Okay. Hello. Sir, am I audible now?
Yeah. Please proceed.
Okay, sir. Okay, my question is regarding something like researcher, novice researcher, or the beginner researcher. My question is that, no, sir. Since the previous one teacher, she has raised on the standardization of the tool. No, since according to my topic, I have to develop one tool. I have to.
Please keep your mobile near to you.
Hello.
Yeah.
Hello, sir. Am I audible?
No, no, you are on a very low volume.
I don't know. Hello, sir?
Yeah. Okay.
Okay.
If you're using earphone, please remove and speak normally.
Okay. Okay. Can I speak, sir?
Yeah, please.
Sir, my question is on like in standardizing in making the tool, no, standardizing the researcher's own tool, like there are totally like thorough processes there. So like some of the researchers, they are fortunate because they will get like a good supervisor or the teachers, but in some cases the researcher or the student, they might not get a good the supervisor or the teachers. So in that case, like if somebody wants to like go solo, no, so is there any like good resources in the form of the books, ebooks, or any sources that could be helpful to the researcher in standardizing this tool thing? Right?
Yeah, actually got it. Mangal, SK Mangal, and Garrett books are there. Even some internet resources are there. I will share with you. And we are going to organize one program. Yeah, please.
Okay, sir. Actually, no. Since 2017, like I have attended one that research methodology course, and in that the program, one research person, he has mentioned one book, a good book, and that book is like actually the totally old book. And I have started searching that book by any hook or crook, no? But till date, I haven't got that book.
Mr. Santosh, in which year you have registered your PhD?
Sir, in 2017, that is way back, but still like...
So when you are going to submit your thesis?
Sir, I am planning to submit my thesis this year, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Have you completed your drafting, and it is in the typing stage or a submission stage, or what stage it is? It is a questionnaire stage or a beginning stage?
No, sir. I'm in the mid of my like work. I have already completed my task.
So have you allotted your time last 17, 18, 19, 20, 21? This is the sixth year. So
have
you allotted your time for your with the dedication manner, with the motivation manner, or you have done your research with a casual manner, spending some time with other activities, or some, spending some time for the research? Are you doing your research with a wholehearted manner or with a casual manner?
No, sir. Since like being a researcher, it is our ethical duty that we have to devote.
Have you published any papers?
Yes, sir. Publications I have done a way back.
How many publications you have done?
Yes, sir. One publication I have done, and that is.
Yes. Okay. How many conferences you have attended?
I have attended many conferences, like.
Your thesis in the typing stage or writing stage?
Yes, sir. It is in the writing process, and I have already like collected.
So here, I'm telling something to you.
Yes, sir.
So actually, here we know something from external sources with asking and something, but the researcher has extraordinary scope to know many things with a self-study and self-investigation. So self-investigation is the most important. Otherwise, you may do your PhD for 15 years. So you need extraordinary energy. For example, you see, you are preparing idli, vada, sambar, or food and everything. You are allotting some time for 10 minutes or 15 minutes for your stove. But if you start for cooking with the help of a candle, if you operate a candle for cooking food, it takes for 3 months or 4 months. Or if you take a low level of fire for cooking something, it is not possible. So here also you registered, I'm sharing with the general purpose, I'm not finding fault with you. You have registered your PhD in 2017. So this is the sixth year. So that means my suggestion is increase your extraordinary motivation. Read very carefully, prepare very well, do something. This may be a sharing for you.
You are 100% right, sir. Just I want to share with you.
Mm.
I met Santosh in Mizoram 2019 March, sir.
Mm.
He is a very dynamic scholar.
Mm.
Here sometimes some research supervisor is also. Balance is very important.
Hmm.
Something is missing. Okay, yes, no problem. Totally, sir. I will take care. Sir, I will inform you. I will share my thesis also with you.
Okay,
So Santosh, actually slip-up method through SPSS, very easily you can standardize reliability, Kronborg, alpha, very easy. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay, Mr. Santosh.
I will organize one program soon.
Okay. So I have some information for the sake of you. I am not questioning about your integrity.
You are right.
A guru should be there for giving the enlightenment answers to you, because you have mentioned your year. So actually, I have done my
MPhil
and PhD and B.Ed and M.Ed, the four courses within 6 years. So regular courses, MED, BED, MED, MPhil, PhD. See, I have spent 15 hours for the, I have prepared, I have done everything. So out of curiosity, I have commitment of energy, we have done things. On the basis of this, I have given some suggestion to you. So you have...
Still, Sar is keeping his notes, Santosh. Sar showed me.
Yes, sir.
I was visited library morning to evening. So... we need the type of dedication, but because of lack of some suggestion, maybe sometimes.
Okay, all the best, Santosh.
Thank you.
Suggestion in the positive sense.
Okay, sir. Definitely, I'll be getting, or I'll be asking some future suggestions. I'll be meeting you with you, like sir, in the future.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you for your valuable time. I think you have some other programs.
Thank you for all the participants, will meet after some time. Have a nice day. Please,
sir, this is our collaborative program.
Yes, okay.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
So here, today I missed one thing. You asked one small question, general question, Amreshwar. After that, I may conclude the program.
Okay, sir.
Small general question,
sir. Okay, sir. Sir, actually, in general, the lifestyles and infrastructure, everything is increasing, quantity, quality, both, sir. But the efficiency of the scholars is not up to the mark when compared with the, when you did see, just now you shared within 6 years.
So what is the reason behind? So you have said very beautiful thing. See, for example, you have prepared 140 food items. You have prepared everything, chicken, mutton, fish, everything with the hot condition. So you invited some people, they have no hunger. They are facing the problem of hunger. They have some stomach problems. They are not in a position to take even a breakfast, but you have prepared 160 items.
Yes.
So you see here, the researcher, because you see in the light, in the previous times, we used to give light. So with the cotton light, we used to pour oil. So if you pour continuously oil, we may see lighting. In the same manner, the researcher has to develop continuously enthusiasm, inspiration, motivation, just like a pouring of oil to see light. In the same manner, if they have to do one thing, continuous learning, continuous doing everything, no gap, no Sunday, no holiday, everything. If you start a research with a continuous person, that continuity activity become a very powerful habit. That powerful habit create extraordinary energy. But here, people are not doing things with the motivation. They have no burning desire. They are giving some blanks. They are giving holidays. They are with low motivation. Lack of a strong goal, lack of motivation, lack of achieving something in the future. That is lacking at present in the researchers. That's why they are always postponing. They are doing their PhD for 6 years or 10 years or 15 years. One person have come recently. He has registered 18 years ago PhD. And what happened the last 18 years? So I worked in the rice mill, sir. Now I have come. So he said, if I give any suggestion, you may come after 22 years, but because you have no any interest. Then we didn't find, because at present, relating with your suggestion, so infrastructure is there, quality, quantity, institution, everything there. But here, burning hunger is there for taking food. In the same manner, extraordinary motivation, extraordinary inspiration is most essential to do research with a short period that they need. For that, they have to go fix goal future. So they have to fix a goal with a limited time. So lack of a fixed goal, lack of motivation, they are postponing and they are not utilizing. So they have no fixed goal and fixed purpose, fixed achievement. Because you have, as a researcher, you have done many things. You have published papers, you have attended conferences, you have applied for central universities, state universities, you have visited many places, you have gone for interviews in the flight, and you have showed your material with just like a shop, and in some interview they said, do you have any publishing house in your place? They said, because of your own thing you have published. Because of your inner motivation, external inspiration, you have done like this. So at present, my suggestion is you have to develop a courage, a motivation, inspiration for achieving something. You have to fix your PhD time. You have to fix your PhD time 3 months or 6 months, or you have to fix everyday goal, not 3 months or 4 months. In the 24 hours, how many hours you are spending for research? So you have to spend some time, and you have to take a review for everyday progress relating with the research. If you are at the same time, not only the everyday, you have to fix a goal for hour. So you have to take time in 1 hour, how much I have worked. So if you take a small unit for doing something, for achieving something, you may get more results. But if you fix for 6 months and relaxed manner, you won't do. So 1 hour fixation of time also most important for doing research. This may be some information, Amre sir.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much for your time.
Yes, I'll meet after
yes, some
time. Please come after this program.
Okay, sir. So thank you very much, Professor Chennai sir, for your wonderful keynote address and discussion. Now I'm requesting Professor Sudarshan sir to deliver a keynote address. Students' perspective, research scholars, what type of problem there, and how to enhance their innovativeness. Over to Professor Sudarshan sir. Sir, I'm making you presenter, sir.
Thank you.
If you have any.
Yeah.
I made presenter, sir. You can use PPT, sir, if you have.
I have to share the content. Very good morning to all. Intelligent, eminent faculty, intelligent students, all others participating in this list. Science, interested to know research. So today, I want to which is social science of humanities. So I'm a scientist. I'm a professor of botany working in Sri Venkateshwara University. And today I just want to deliver this service. First of all, those who are interested to do research, you must know whether we are doing in sciences, arts, social sciences, commerce, wherever it is. So we must select a good guide. That is the first thing. Just now, Chinnaya is discussing, and other students also interacting, this is scholars, regarding selection of good guide. And you also choose a topic. So if you choose a topic, then it will be useful to the society. That should be our motto. So that's why I kept my title here, Think Globally and Act Locally. So you have to think what area you want to work. You have to select the topic so that you will have, you can choose your guide also. Nowadays, we are not selecting topics, we are not selecting guides as we wish. Amar, is it audible?
Sir, audible, but if you increase the volume, it's maybe good, sir.
I understand there is a problem in your speaker only, because last time we recorded, my voice is very clear.
But okay, sir. Anyhow, thank you, sir.
Okay. Maybe if any other speakers finding difficulty, you can, I will try, because it's perfectly, audio is perfectly coming, full sound. Any audience,
okay, sir, please.
Please, if you have any complaint, please message.
Even YouTube Amar. Also, just I watched it, sir. YouTube also low volumes.
Okay. I have increased, this is the maximum I can do it here. Last time also I have same problem, but in the recording it was good. Okay. Okay, thank you. Let me continue. So, coming to the research topic, one should select a topic which is pertaining to their area. We, for example, Sri Venkateswara University. Our university is in Rayalaseema area. So, in Rayalaseema area, because the teachers are having expertise and they know very well about that area, they should be able to guide the student in that area. And students also can able to select some topic which is related to that area, then it will be useful. So coming to the selection of a guide, if an experienced person accompanies, the journey will be easy and comfortable. That's always when teacher knows everything, it's easy for the student. Similarly, for a beginner, the experienced person is required who knows the way. So he knows the route, he knows the methods. So it will be easy for the student. Those who have acquaintance, they have acquaintance. So in the with the research, they have acquaintance with the research. So, and those who have know the route very well are more useful to the beginner or those beginner research scholars than a person who knows only imaginary route. Some people say, oh, that thing, I can do it. I can guide you. So that may not help the students. The teacher or guide should know the clear route. A well-experienced person can be specially called good guide. So he is useful and helpful to the research scholar as an authentic guide. This is the first thing. So most of the research scholars, they fail to select and they suffer, they sometimes commit suicides. So that pinches me a lot. But we should be vigilant to select a good guide. So based on nowadays, many pseudo or false guides spread great number. There are many people, they pose as if they have very good expertise, but it is not good. So here we should have a teacher can attract. He has a lot of publicity, other things, but the research scholar should be cautioned to think and act carefully before selecting a reliable guide. So this guide should not be a charlatan or fraud person. Some people nowadays, they demand a lot. So research, before you do, you have some goal, you want to do some research. So you should now choose a good person, good guide with some experience who knows the way, so that you are running in the right track. So coming to the next topics, mostly I have told you my topic today is interdisciplinary research. So the research, maybe you can specific topic also you can choose in a special specific subject, but sometimes interdisciplinary research involves the combination of two or more academic disciplines into one activity. So your PhD, in which you are involving one or two or more subjects, disciplines. That is how these type of things are called interdisciplinary research. And then to advance fundamental understanding or to solve problems whose solutions are beyond the scope of single discipline or area of research practice. So such research is called interdisciplinary science research. So coming to interdisciplinary research, the main aim of interdisciplinary research is being out holistic approach to the research. And then mutual association with all fields of natural or social science. Developing a new knowledge through research, that combination of skills and perspective of multidisciplines. So many disciplines are involved so that you can do better and then to solve the local problem. And then this local problem, if you could even solve, which can be shared all over the world, and maybe you can use the technology which is available in the all over the world. So that's how. So your main focus, local focus, could help tackle global problem. So you, that is the main motto here. The local focus could help tackle global problem. So I just now I told you the universities should allow the students to select some problems of that particular university area, and then by using the technology available all over the world, solve your local problem, and you can share with the world that all the findings. That's way you will be highlighted. So coming to the my own experiences, I just want to talk to you. When my mother used to give treatment to the patients on every Sunday, long queues. They used to take the medicine and they were cured. Number of people have cured, even though they used to go to the allopathic system of doctors, but here they are sure of getting cured. So they used to come and take the treatment. So that this idea sparkled in my mind. Okay, when my mother is treating, this should be useful to all. So how I can do it? How can I validate it? That is the problem. How to validate it? So this is my question. This is my research topic. And then I wrote a project for the Indian Council of Medical Research. And then I got the junior research fellow. I was selected, and then they gave funds. So I carried out my research work. So why I'm telling you this, one should know how they can able to do. I joined Sri Venkateswara University and trying to get guide. My guide has changed 7 topics, but nothing could able to finalize. Finally, I stick to this topic, my mother medicine, or traditional medicines, and carried out my research. So before I want to talk about multidisciplinary approach here, I just want to tell you about science. Whether we have understanding about science, sir, why you are asking? Yes. We have true knowledge about science, then we should find out what is life. Till there is a lacuna. According to me, the science should be fact-finding and fault-finding. The science should be one way it flourishes, nourishes, and nurtures. Other way it crunches, crushes, and destroys. So the science have two edges. So it is two-edged knife. It will able to cure, it will able to treat, it can do anything, good things. At the same time, it can able to farmers, or that means it can also do the good or bad. So the students should be ethical, select the topic with ethics. If you select the topic without ethics, you know what has happened now, how we are suffering. So according to me, we should have ethics in selection and doing research. One of my students was working on transgenics, gene transfer. He is having with good intention. And then with the good intention, what he has done, he wants to increase the thickness of the leaf so that he feels he can get the resistance. But we advised him not to do that genetic manipulation because it may end up with some disaster. This is advice to all the scientists, all the researchers, whoever is working. Think twice before you decide on gene manipulations. Suppose if genes are manipulated for better things, for good, it's good. Otherwise, that time itself we told him to select different method so that he can increase the resistance by way of producing trichomes, more trichomes on the surface of the leaf surface, so that insects will be repelled out. But if leaf thickness is increased, like mulberry leaves, the insects will eat the leaves. So instead of his research work, insect resistance, they become insect pro. So that is the danger. If you don't follow ethics, that is a danger. So this technology, I still feel if anybody wants or interested, I can guide them. It is called eco-friendly technology because it is not affecting the insect, or insect is also not affecting the plant. So productivity is also not effective. It's good. So my advice to the science students or research scholars, it's better to go for eco-friendly technology rather than manipulating genes in the wrong side. You know, we are suffering with COVID. A lot of people are affected. Our economy ups and downs because gene manipulated. They have manipulated the genes and the result is COVID-19. We are all suffering. So this caution, we have done it long back with my student, but somehow advisors, we should give good advice to student. A student also should follow the advice so that he might have ended with very good eco-friendly technology by now, but that has not happened. But still, what I say, we should have ethics and in doing research. That will be one very important thing I want to tell you. And coming to the selection of research topics, I just now told you it is locally, you should able to select the problem and then use all the technology, all the, you have internet facility nowadays. So these facilities definitely able to help us to know the what are the findings. But be sure there are certain departments and some guides, they will be replicating the same work with different altered titles. Little, maybe sometimes they work on some animal, same thing they will do some other animal. So that way you will not get the original findings. It may be duplication of work. So most of our Indian research is going to be not motivated towards world standards. We should do in the world standards, but we should have world-class facilities too. So wherever there is good facilities for doing out such work, there only you have to do. Otherwise, don't attempt that. So this way, I just suggest students not to commit for the research where there is no facilities. Facilities are must, ethics are must, good guide is a must, selection of a good topic is a must at the same time. So no replication of work. This is my sincere advice. And then you should have a quality of research so that if you have good quality of research, then you will have more and more value to your publication as well as your you will get a suitable employment, and you have to compete with the world. Always a research scientist or research scholar should compete with the world with the good impact factor journals. They have to find and publish it. Last class I have given a talk on how to publish your work, but now this is how we have to choose our topic. That is my interest today. So we have one important point I just want to discuss today in the multidisciplinary approach. So ethnobotany, a lot of data is available about multidisciplinary sciences, but because I am the scientist botanist, as a botanist I just feel like exchanging some idea about traditional medicine, which is my favorite, and then which forms an example for others to follow perhaps. So here several definitions are there for ethnobotany, but basic concept has not changed much, and the scope of ethnobotany is increasing day by day. Day by day it is increasing. According to the Schultz, ethnobotany is defined as the study of relationship between people of a primitive society and plants. So this is very, very for in interesting topic for Indians. In India, we have lots of tribal people, lots of traditional medicine being practiced in India, otherwise mother's medicine. So mother treats, initially the children are treated by mother. So this knowledge, traditional medicine, comes under multidisciplinary approach. See this next slide. So ethnobotany as an interdisciplinary science, it involves a lot of things. For example, a medicine plant is given as medicine, then one should identify the ingredient or plants used in that medicine. So we need one field taxonomy there to identify the plant. And then we need that plant to be conserved. Otherwise, if it is available in wild, after our forests are destroyed, you can't find that plant. Maybe over exploitation results in loss of that habitat of the plant. As a result, we have to conserve that plant so that that plant is available for the treatments. And then, so we need conservative methods. If you want to do research on ethnobotany, you need all this time, like forestry and agriculture. And then similarly, this medicinal plant can be cultivated either in wild or in the farm fields. And then we have to identify what type of medicine it is having. You should know about medical details, medical details. Archaeology, I'll just tell you how all things are involved. Religion, social customs, geography, anthropology, social and culture, language and linguistics, economics, mythology, ecology. So all these things together, put together, it is interdisciplinary. That's why I chosen this topic, so that I can do justice. So apart from this, other factors also involved. If you want to validate your traditional medicine knowledge, you have to take the help of a pharmacologist, chemist, and the clinical work to be also carried out. So that's how ethnobotany is an interdisciplinary science. See, most of the medicines, artemisinin, you can see the digitalis, so many compounds today which are used in the modern medicine are from the plant source. That gives you, that means from various plants, different plants gave different medicine. So all these findings, because of the work of the various scientists, maybe botanist, pharmacologist, chemist, maybe nowadays bioinformatics also, drug development schemes, lot of things are involved. So the future research is with the multidisciplinary approach, so that in China, see, we may feel proud of India, but at the same time, traditional materia medica of China was prepared in 1974 itself. So they could able to do it. Why not India? What to say? All the information what earlier exists, when I mean, maybe before that, this knowledge, medical knowledge, that is plants used for various treatments, for not documented properly. No time and no systematic documentation. So as a result, today we have not documented it. So the real treatments and the cure observed and found by the traditional medical practitioners are not documented properly in a systematic manner. So today we don't have such an valuable information. When humans are serving, themselves are serving as experimental tool voluntarily, now you are again testing in a Western way in the animal model. What type of justice is this? So the time has come now. You have to choose a best topic with multidisciplinary approach, with the commitment of, so just now the people are discussing about commitment. So we used to work from morning to night, 24/7. We used to sleep in the labs, and we used to do the research. Nowadays, I don't know how many people are enjoying vacations, holidays. No, a researcher is 24/7 job. You have to complete. You must have interest. You must have attention. You must have concentration. You should have contemplation. You have dedication and devotion. And you should have moreover energy and financial support so that you can carry out your research very effectively. And then, you know, ethnobotanically, people have to work in the tribal area, where you have to go to tribes, and then so you have to understand the mood of the tribe, and the tribes will not tell you the truth. Immediately when you go, they are afraid to tell the truth. Why? If they reveal the secret of their medical practice, they feel that it will be lost. It will not work forever. That is the tribal mood. So how difficult it is to get the real truth from the tribals. Very difficult. So it is time testing valid medical use, but now you have to use this field work. And then scrutiny of herbarium. See, you can also get the information from herbarium specimens, and large international herbaria is available from the herbaria. We can get the information. Similarly, in the literature also, uses of plants were documented. So the research here involves literature, that is text or sculptures, all the ancient in literature also, plant uses have been referred. So based on that information also, you can do research. And then based on herbarium records also, we can do research. based on the field work, currently whatever knowledge is having, that can be also done. Similarly, scrutiny of ancient sculptures, temples, so various places they have recorded and documented the folk medicine. Scrutiny of plants and the plant parts from archaeological sites and excavations. Study of fossil plant material and the remains. So all these things form a multidisciplinary approach to get the truth from the uses of for the uses of medicinal plants, so that you can say this is the claim from the, we are using this plant from the times immemorial. So that way, this information will be very, very useful. I just want to take 2 minutes. Today, you have a lot of problems to identify. Amar, what is the time? Time to?
Sir, no, no problem, sir, please.
No, I'll just take 5 to 10
minutes. The guest of honor is not coming to deliver, so we can.
Okay, okay. So this is very, very keen to interact. I think participants will bear with me. I just want to share this. People nowadays question, who came first? The seed came first or plant came first? So everybody again, oh, some say seed, some say plant. What is the beginning? This is how I question myself. I do research, going depth of the beginning of botany. So I gave this topic here, just a 2 minutes topic. It's botanical bio. You know, botany, zoology, both are, we know it's biology. But botany is the beginning, one of the stages of development of biology. I say botany is one of the stages of development of biology. And coming to botany, it should start somewhere. Where it should start? Either start with seed or plant. This is $1 million question. So we should try to attempt. So a system of micro complex fertilized, this is called seed. So what is seed? If you question, what is seed? Simple question. Seed is the core of the plant. Seed is a micro compressed fertilized part of the plant. It's okay. There is seed in microform in every plant. That every scientist know, plants have got totipotency. So any plant part we can culture with the help of tissue culture, and once again you are getting the plant again. So do you need, now you can see the definition of seed is changed. Seeding is the leading process of bio in plants. Seeding is the leading process of bio in plants. So the sugarcane also propagates. It leads its life with the stems. That is the seed for the sugarcane there. So wherever there is a leading process, that is the seeding process. So now, who came first, seed or plant? Then, so physical expression of seed into tree is not false. That means there is seed inside the plant. Seedling to plant is also not false. So there is seedling and the physical expression, expression of seed in the tree. Just now I told you it is having totipotency. There are seeds in the fruit. Yes, there are seeds in the fruits. Similarly, where is the place or to pretension or for the false illusion, who came first? Moreover, tree donates life to the seed. That means the vital energies are donated by the plants to the babies, that is embryo, that is into the seed. So when you compare, this is available in the book called Vyasa Manjari, written by Sri Sri Guru Viswasmurti, a spiritual person who wrote this. I am highly thankful for him for sparing a lot of time with me and discussing about the seed. So seed, again, I'm going to answer you. You are not got the real answer now. Who came first, seed or plant? All of you are anxiety. You have anxiety, I know that. So next slide, let us see. So all of us know, seeds are inside the fruit, and the present seed, which is not responsible for the formation of the first seed. This is the clue I've given you. Present seed, what you are seeing, is not responsible for the formation of the first seed. Okay. So there is micro and macro nature. So one, what you are seeing is macro. Okay. For fruits or plants, seedling is the beginning. Seedling is the beginning, not the seed. Seedling is the beginning. But present seed and seed in the beginning are not the same. Same seed I just now told you. And then that means, 1 minute. First form seed is different. First form seed is different from the existing seed or current seed. So once the seeds are in micro form, seeding is the leading process of bio in plants. So the seed what is today is not the seed which is in the beginning. And I have already clarified who is coming from whom. So seeds formation is only procreation, only procreation. So this is my interesting topic. So I end up with one quotation, that is, the botanical vitals, including feeding, dieting, and medical qualities, inspire and influence aspects and prospects of bio, just like relativity in physics. So I think I could able to complete my talk. So the research, what I have carried out, is also multidisciplinary research with pharmacology, with the chemistry, and ethnobotany. So I could be able to answer you better. Please, if you have any questions, please interact with me.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your wonderful keynote address. This is the need of the hour. Few days back, I read an article. Some of our scientists, ICMR scientists, they identified plants in Himalaya hills, Jammu, Kashmir, is purified COVID-19 pandemic. So see, whatever already is available in India, but we are not able to know. But since time immemorial, the tribal people are practicing many things. So you are 100% right. The script text, whatever available plants in northeastern states are also, how the formation is taking place now, some of researchers are working, they are making, naming, and publicizing. So what is your suggestion for the researchers to very less number of research scholars are linking with health related issues? Because whenever we are supposed to do any research regarding health, we need the ethics board in the university, the approval from the ethics board and permission from other. So it is not an easy task like any other. So what is your suggestion for the research scholars to, because without health, nothing is there, sir. COVID-19 pandemic will launch.
Recently, the government of India contacted me regarding protocols to develop for the production of a large scale production of medicinal plants with the help of hydroponics. Something happened, but it's okay.
No, no, sir. I want to see you more full screen. Okay. That's why I just dragged.
No problem, no problem. So the government of India asked me to develop protocols. So there is a need now. A lot of protocols are needed to develop how to propagate in a best way with the best required features, qualities in the medicinal plant. So people have to do a lot of scope in India. How many medicinal plants are there? If for each and every plant, because we don't get them freely in the forest. So there is a need to cultivate them, and then in large quantities they are needed. I just want to caution in one more thing. Today in India, we are not using pesticides and other chemicals for chemical-free agriculture is not available today. Today we are using indiscriminate use of pesticides. As a result, you have seen in Sri Lanka recently, they are struggling to get vegetables, any food, and very difficult because they used pesticides in large quantities. So India and China are also coming next. There is next turn is ours because we are using a lot of pesticides indiscriminately. So they are leaching into from the agricultural fields, they are reaching to the borewells, rivers, ultimately, all of us are drinking contaminated water. I cannot say fully here, but it is danger bells are ringing. So this is just now the time has come. You have to put in your do research and find out ways how best we can keep away from all these things. And then a lot of pollution of plastic. We can't eat fish from the sea because they have plastic inside. So danger bells are there. And when you have nothing to eat, we have to struggle. So ultimately, we have to find out some ways how we get. You know, rich countries, they are buying organic vegetables and eating. So we don't have virgin soils. If we have virgin soils, then we can go for organ cultivation. I suggest there is a lot of scope for multidisciplinary research, and then a lot of problems, which I told you many problems, validation of medicines, cultivation of medicine plants, like a lot of research opportunities are available. And I'm just telling about plant sciences. I hope you are 100 work series of 100 workshops. I think we are going to result in good bringing awareness among the scientific community, our research scholars, and even scientists, because nowadays what we are living in urban, we are releasing lot of urban waste, which is in turn this sewage is used by the farmers to cultivate their all our vegetables are grown in sewage, and industrial toxins, all we are eating, they are giving a return gift for us. So be careful. So I ask you, I request all of you, stay safe, stay healthy, eat healthy. Amar, next question. Anybody,
thank you, sir. Please? Sir, here, few of them, they texted because of network, they are not able to talk. Jay Chitra, doctor from Tamil Nadu, using of pesticides causes health hazards. Is there any alternative solution?
Stop using them. Use natural pesticide, neem oil, biological controls. Don't use pesticides. That's my concern. Use biological pesticide or biological controls can be used. So that is one way of protecting from the use of pesticide.
Thank you, sir. Vidyasagar Kumar from Pune is asking how research in botany different from social sciences research.
Research is research only, but the topics and subject only varies. But Because I am a botany professor, so I just oriented my talk towards botany, that's all. Yeah.
Any Thank questions? You, sir. Thank you very much. Is there anyone? Please, I am allowing the participant to interact if we have another one or 2 minutes. Yeah, now I allowed. Participants can talk directly. Anyone? So anyone can ask your research related. Vidyasagar Kumar, I think you have many queries. We will do some other time.
Maybe you can WhatsApp me. I can answer you. My number is 9989053632. I repeat, 9989053632 is my name.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. I will send 2 of your appreciation certificates soon, sir. And we need your blessings in future also.
Thank you.
And thank you, sir. With your permission, now may I move for a paper presentation, sir? May I request the scholars to
go ahead.
Thank you, sir. Thank you
thank
very
you
much.
Very much for your allow me for to talk again, giving me second opportunity, Amar. And I'm thankful to your vice chancellor and our vice chancellor, Professor K. Raja Reddy Garu. And I also indebted to your university. So thank you very much.
Welcome, sir. Most welcome, sir. Now, with the permission of the keynote speakers, I'm moving next program, paper presentation. There are 4 paper presenters. Number one, Dr. K. Radhika, Associate Professor, and A. Vasaya from Department of Economics, Sri Venkateswara University. And Muhammad Safir Kefi and Dr. B. Kathirishan from from Velur, and another one, same from Sri Venkateswara University, Dr. K. Radhika Madam and Prasanna Kumar, and last one is ourselves. The first, Dr. Radhika Madam and A. Vasaya, first title of the paper, Economics of Urban Informal Sector, a Case Study in Chittoor District, Andhra Pradesh. The second paper presenter, Muhammad, the conflict between here orality is from English background. Dr. K. Radhika, again, economics, rural unemployment. And the final one, I'm going to provide this one and not research. The research, just information based paper to sensitize our research scholars and to motivate to use ICT tools from searching content to data analysis and report writing A to Z. In each step research process, you can use your research ICT tools, where you can use what type of ways are there to enhance. We are going to, now without further delay, now I'm requesting A. Vasaya to present his paper. Now, I made Vasaya as a co-host and presenter. Please, over to Vasaya. So you are not audible, Mick.
Hello?
Yeah, please, please. Yeah.
Sir, respected to all, sir.
Yeah, please. You not joined sir, through laptop?
No, sir, mobile, sir.
Okay, please proceed.
Sir, respected to all, sir, Vice-Chancellor, hello, Vice-Chancellors and other doctorates, each and everyone, good morning to all, sir. So my topic, my article is Economics of Urban Informal Sector, a Case Study in Chittoor District. Hello.
Please proceed. No need to give any response from our side. Just you proceed.
Okay. Thank you, sir. So introduction, the informal sector or unorganized sector, it is also comprised enterprise which own account enterprise operated by the own account of the workers or unorganized enterprises employing hired workers. They are essentially proprietary and partnership enterprises. The term informal sector has been in vogue only during the past 2 and a half decades, although economic activities have been carried out outside the formal sector ever since the beginning of the process of modern economic development. In fact, the term informal sector was the first used by the John Keith Hurd in 1973 in the study of the employment pattern in urban Ghana. Generally speaking, in the informal activities are also activities which are not recorded in the official returns, and second one, incomes is not disclosed. Informal sector activities, its participants are also residual left by the formal sector on grounds of limited scope for advancement. Informal sector is often considered as a shadow economy, underground economy, and micro enterprises and petty commodity production units. Informal sector includes the self-employees, casual workers, and unpaid family workers, and consists of very small units of manufacturing, construction, trade and commerce, transport, repair and servicing sectors run as a one-man show. That means worker cum owner are employing a few persons, notably less than 10. The informal sector to economic activities that are fundamentally permissible, but they are carried out in way that it is not compliance with the current government law. Micro enterprise refers to a very small business, and all these business which can be either formal operations done in compliance with the law, or they can be informal activities. Hence, the researcher intended to purchase is a researcher on the problem initiated economics of urban informal sector, a case study in Chittoor district. So by need for the study in both developing and developing countries, the formal sector is connected to the formal sector of national and global economy through the subcontracting networks and commodity chains. The informal economy is growing at a faster rate than the formal economy. The informal sector proves to be a major mechanism for the economic growth and development in most of the less developed countries. The informal sector is the largest source of employment, investment, and government revenue. So this is because informal sector offers the best opportunity for the upward mobility of lifeline of the poor people and children. There is a domination of the unskilled and uneducated migrants who work in the informal sector. There is a domination of unskilled and uneducated migrants who work in the informal sector. The share of the informal unorganized sector is more than 50%, and given the size of the India, dependence on surveys of unorganized informal sector is inevitable. A scope of this study of urban informal sector, the urban informal sector economy has untapped potential to contribute to the post-conflict recovery and reconstruction, supporting the livelihoods of the communities affected by the violence or disaster, and contributing to the provision of the basic services in crisis-affected settings. Urban refugee economics also contribute to the economic development in host cities, particularly where the refugees are also granted the right to work. Informal settlements are also dynamic centers of the economic activity, supporting the vibrant and specialized economies. Understanding of the complexity and the social solidarity of these specialized economies is essential to building the social inclusion, especially in the participatory slum upgrading programs. The predominance of informal sector has become the common phenomenon, causing the serious concern on the two planets and administrators all over the country. The stickiness in the growth of job opportunities in the informal in the past decade has led to further deterioration in the employment conditions and the wages. The problem faced by the cities due to the lack of employment opportunities and predominance of informal sector. Sir, its objectives is to examine the employment pattern in the urban informal sector, to identify the movement and absorption of the workers of urban informal sector, and to trace the socio-economic conditions of the select workers of urban informal sector, and to examine the economic plight of the workers in the urban informal sector and to find the problems and suggest remedial measures. Its hypothesis, sir. The employment pattern in urban informal sector is significant. The movement and the absorption of the workers of urban informal sector is significant. The socio-economic conditions of the workers in the urban informal sector is significant. Research methodology is multi-stage stratified random sampling technique is made use in the collection of the primary data. Chittoor district is divided into three revenue divisions, that is Madanapalli, Tirupati and Chittoor. In the first stage, all the three revenue divisions were also selected. From each revenue division, two mandals were also selected in the second stage. In the third stage, from the each mandal, three textile shops and three hotels were also selected. In the final stage, from the each hotel and textile shop, 25 respondents were selected randomly. There were sample size is 450. So these respondents were also interviewed with the pre-designed and self-structured questionnaire prepared to collect the primary data set. Secondary data, it was collected from the various sources, books, newspapers, journals, and National Informatics Center, Chittoor District, Chittoor. So data analysis, the data collected from the sample respondents has been collected and tabulated after the editing, coding, computing, and analyzed with the help of the SPPS package. The descriptive statistical procedures like mean, standard deviation were computed. The statistical tools administered to test the significance of the variance are t-test and chi-square test analysis. Limitation, the present research is confined to the two sectors like shops and hotels only, sir. So this is my article. So my conclusion, I humbly request to the resource persons to give the advice and suggestion for further modifications, so as they are enabled to improve the present research work, sir, I emulate and incorporate the present research work and further improve it. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Vasayaji. Actually, we need a PPT because whenever you are delivering it, just it comes and goes only. So always better if they see, they can understand, we can see again. Now I can't, whatever I recorded, I can show. Okay, anyhow, but in future, please, I am requesting, I don't want to exclude anyone. That's why I allowed, otherwise without presentation, without slide, it is not good. Anyhow, now over to the participants. If you have any suggestion to improve his research, because they are still doing, so a lot of scope for the improvement. If you feel anything, please, over to the participants. Anyone?
Okay.
What are the causes for unemployment in Chittoor district, according to your review of literature?
Sir, unemployment in actually in hotels, vendors, textiles, mostly informal. That means unorganized sector employment. It is also more in Chittoor district, sir.
No. Reasons for causes for unemployment. You are doing
a lack of education, sir. Not high educated. So then low educated people mostly working in the textiles and hotels, sir. They are not well educated. So they are also working in the, they are also selected these sectors.
Why you have selected this topic?
Most of the workers are also working in the unorganized sector, that means urban informal sector.
Okay,
plot of the workers' conditions of the workers. to improve their living conditions.
Okay. So any other participants? Here someone is questioning.
Sir.
Sir, how far is the government able to rectify, what schemes are there to rectify this unemployment among the people? Especially, is there any age group like certain criteria, like these people are mostly unemployed, or did you make any research towards that, sir?
When the government, it is also to implement the minimum wage act, it is also to protection for that workers, man.
I'm not asking about the wages. I'm asking exclusively, is there any particular age criteria that these people are mostly unemployed, or like did you make any research from your side regarding that aspect?
Madam, any means minimum, there is no age criteria, madam. From 15 years to 60-65 years of the workers, they are also engaging in the hotels and textiles. Lack of education.
No, sir. Vasaya, please listen properly. Here, employment is not only organized or unorganized sector. If someone is working in a unorganized sector also, that is, it will come under employment only. So, unemployed is someone he doesn't have any work to do, or willingly he is don't want to do. Okay. According to Government of India and the national and international organization, already defined what is unemployment. In your study, do you have operational definition? What is unemployment in your study?
The people cannot working at regular time. From the people cannot working regular time, that is unemployment.
Okay, based on you, actually everyone have their own definition. Ma'am, Yadanapudi ma'am is asking, is there, suppose some age group, 21 or 24 to 30, this age group in general, after completing all their education institution, education degrees, they're not in a position to go for, to do any work under an unorganized sector. They need government jobs or some white collar jobs or something. So are you find any such type of age group in your, during your study, this age group people are more, are not working anywhere?
Not working anywhere, so not only textiles and hotels, but also other sectors, they are also working. But I select only textiles and hotels.
Okay. So your research area only on these two areas?
Yes, it is only confined to the hotels and textiles. I only select this.
Okay, how you are going to select the sample for data collection? What type of sampling techniques you will use?
Listen, prime.
Random.
Yes. Okay.
Anyhow, next time, because you need to present some more progress seminars, so you can prepare some other time with PPT, and you can give based on the research process, identification of problem too. So anyhow, congratulations, all the best. And someone asked here, how we can generate employment in your area.
Sir, what was your method? Is it qualitative or quantitative method you have chosen, sir?
It's quantitative method.
So how we can generate employment in your area according to your study? And Priyanka is asking.
Sir, quantitative method.
No. Method is okay. How we can generate employment in your area according to your study? So through your study,
I'm also to provide the employment opportunities to that people to educate their children, and they are also very well, and they get other opportunities in another sector also.
Okay, Vasaya, thank you very much. I think we'll move further. Now, Safir, over to you. Yeah, thank you, Vasaya.
Okay,
over to Safir. Safir, I made you presenter.
Yes, sir.
And you are a co-host now. Share your screen.
Sir, I apologize. Yesterday also you told me to send PPT. I have a problem with this technology.
What?
Is it audible?
No, not audible nicely.
Now is it okay?
Yeah, okay.
Because I was using my headset and now it's left.
Better to remove, yeah.
I have some problem with these technological glitches, that is this PPT and all these things. So I usually present...
No, please, next time I don't allow you, because yesterday itself I told, please.
Okay, sir.
Without PPT, because in education we have three types of learners, minimum, auditory, visionary, kinesthetic. Suppose yes, someone have some doubt, if I want to show to them, if slide is there, I can show. Otherwise, maybe language teachers you are using more oral, but we need, okay, next time. Okay. This is the last.
Okay, sir, no problem. I try. Okay, sir, can I proceed? I think there is some echo. Okay. Is that okay now?
No, echo is there.
Please wait, sir. Let me check with my mobile.
Say something, whether it is coming or not. No, it is not audible. You are unmuted.
Locked, sir.
Yeah, please. You join through devices. Huh?
Video. Okay, now it's okay, sir.
Okay, please proceed.
Because there is power problems here, so I joined through phone and this one. Okay, thank you, sir. I'm coming to my paper. The topic of my paper is the conflict between orality and Anthropocene écriture. In Temsula House, the poem, the old storyteller. So there are two main topics, that is orality and écriture. Écriture is just nothing writing. So even from the evolution of human being, we used the sounds. In the ancient times, human beings used sounds for hunting and for communication. And specific sounds were coined with specific meanings, and they communicated for their need of their body, for their for alleviating their hunger, for the purpose of hunting and all these things. Naturally, these sounds became words and sentences, and meanings were conveyed or joined with these sounds. That was the beginning of the evolution of language. And gradually this developed, and they began to communicate with specific language. And based on regions, civilization, many oral languages came to existence. The written language, the primitive stage of written language was in the form of pictures, which was carved on the walls of the caves and on the skins of the animals. But the scripture came late, and the oral tradition was used in many occasions, even from the ancient times, in the form of songs and stories. This was the source of history, or this was a source of realizing the tradition, culture, ethics, and values of a specific group, even from the beginning of civilization. This tradition followed to many cultures, even before the development of the process of writing. So the writing came very late in the 17th and 18th century, and it became very prominent or very advanced with the development of the printing press by Caxton. So this was the condition of the cultures or civilization in the ancient times in the world. Coming to India, we have Harappan civilization and Indus Valley civilization, many civilizations, and this was the condition in India also. But this changed with the coming of the colonial powers. They wanted to portray the traditional culture in India, though there were many scriptures, the writing and literacy was limited to some sections of the society, that is the higher caste. Only they were able to read and write, or they were indulged in the knowledge process. So this was limited to the higher dignified category of the people in India. And when the colonized powers came to colonial powers came to India, they encouraged the Indians to educate themselves. Their aim was not the education and development of the subjects in India, but they wanted cheap labor, cheap educated Indians to work for the empire. So they gave importance to written language literacy, and they gave much importance to the less importance to the oral tradition which was existing in India. They discouraged these oral traditions, and they wanted the people of India to be away from the oral tradition, which was rich with stories and songs in the form of folk cultures. And they wanted the people of India to follow the colonial culture, ethics, and values. And they painted this oral tradition in a specific way that the colonial powers told the people that this is not the way for development and progress. Only through the following of texts or books, which is in the written form, you can attain progress and development. Naturally, these people began to leave this oral tradition in their to the history, and began to read and write following the paths of the British colonizers. But because of this, what we lost is a treasure of culture, treasure of history, treasure of ethics, treasure of values. This lose or this losing of culture or this values, ethics from our culture or tradition is specified in the poem by Themsla Awo, the old storyteller. Themsla Awo will be very familiar for the Northeast, especially for Nehu. I think she belonged to your university. And she tells that she is from Northeast, and Northeast is very rich in cultural aspects. They have their own traditions, their own folk culture. They have different ethics and values, different from all other regions of the country. So she tells that I listen stories. In her poem, she tells that I listen stories from my forefathers, from my grandparents. And I also want to tell the stories to the younger generation, but they are not interested. So the oral tradition is losing from the cultures. The culture is losing the oral tradition. The main problem with this loss is that the younger generation is not able to realize the value of their own culture, because we have oral tradition in the form of stories. Stories may be cooked up stories or imaginary stories, or it may be the stories of the individuals or the incidents happened in their own society or culture. And these stories will be having many characters from human beings and from animals. It will be close to nature. All these stories will be related to some incidents in the history, and this stories carry the incidents of history or the information from history from generation to generation. And this develops the mental psyche of the younger generation. And they are able to realize how valuable our culture is, how valuable our traditions are, how valuable our legacy is. But when this younger generation keep away from the oral tradition, and they want to go deep into the written scriptures or that writings, they are losing much information about their own culture. For example, our festivals, our ceremonies, occasions, all these are related to oral tradition. There will be songs and there will be many stories regarding many. How much time shall I take, sir?
Okay, another 20 minutes.
Okay, sir, no problem. Thank you. So there are many incidents or occasions, many incidents or stories regarding our festivals, our ceremonies. And these all things are losing from our culture. Naturally, for example, we in Kerala celebrate Onam. And for the celebration or the reason of the, one of the reasons for celebrating Onam is based on the myth of Mahabali. There are many versions of that story or myth. Some give importance to Mahabali, or some give importance to Vamana. And there are many incidents regarding this. And the people of India, people of Kerala connect it to their own soil. And these stories are losing when the oral tradition is leaving from the culture. And we have a festival called Vishu. Why we are celebrating Vishu? This younger generation doesn't know about the value of the festival or the reason for the festival. It is something related to our own culture, our own tradition. These reasons or the importance of this festival or the reasons for the festival were handed over from the generation to generation. But because of the loss of this oral tradition of the stories or the story tradition in our society, many information is losing from our culture. For example, why we are celebrating the Vishu? It is called the Vishu in some areas, especially in Bengal. So it is the festival of harvest. Okay, it is a festival of harvest. It is celebrated in Madam. Madam is the Malayalam month. It is in summer. So it will happen only after the harvest. That is the harvest in the Kerala rural areas, that is paddy harvest. And the granaries will be full and they will be happy. And it's the time of fruits, that is jackfruit, mango, and all these fruits will be blooming and having fruits at that time. That is why the Kerala people will be having a kani, or in the early morning for Madam, first date of Madam, they will be having many fruits and many grains in their basket, and they will be watching in the early morning. Their first sight will be that. That means it is full, that is the fruitful season. It is the festival of harvest, or it reminds us that the God has bestowed, or that God has given this much to see and to enjoy. This all information regarding the festivals, the ceremonies, the rituals were handed over from the forefathers or the grandparents to the younger children. But this is losing now. And many other occasions, many other rituals are celebrated just for namesake. The younger generation are not aware of these information behind this festival, our myths, our concepts, our stories, which are in our locality are losing just because it is not stored in the memory of the younger generation. And only because of that, these culture, tradition, legacy are losing. We have lost all these tradition and information about these are losing from our society. But in many other cultures, when we look at many other cultures, this is followed. This oral tradition is followed. Now, in post-colonial criticism, Temsilavo's poem is very peculiar in this aspect. The post-colonial critics want to revive this oral tradition. It is a resistance against the colonial aspect which give dominance to writing. The colonial powers wanted to keep away or discourage the oral tradition because they wanted these cultures to be destroyed from the society. They wanted to keep away or wipe away the culture, legacy, tradition of these colonies or indigenous groups and wanted to establish their own European culture. But post-colonial critics says that we have to revive the oral tradition because it is the storehouse of all the information about our indigenous culture, indigenous values, indigenous rituals, ceremonies, and all the aspects regarding our own life are filled in all these stories and songs. So postcolonial criticism is encouraging the research regarding oral tradition. For example, folk songs and folk stories, these are all storehouses. Temslawo tells that these are treasures. It is having immense amount of information which will help our society, our culture to enrich itself. We can enrich our culture only by following these traditions followed in the past. That is Temslawo's point of view. She tells that the younger generation is not listening to this. There are many reasons for this, for the discouragement or the disappearance of this oral tradition. The one reason he points that the relationship between the elder generation, older generation, and the younger generation is diminishing. There is a gap in between the generations. That is because of urbanization. People are running behind money, and they are not able to see the monetary benefit or the direct benefit in all these matters. Why we are have to listen to all these stories? These are stupid stories. They will be telling stories about some supernatural elements. They will be telling stories about some animals. They will be telling about some incidents. They are not worried about all these things. They are only behind money. So the urbanization kept away the older generation from the younger generation. The older generation will be living in rural areas, and the younger generation wanted to leave the rural areas to urban areas for their employment or their progress in life or career development. So the younger generation or the kids are not able to listen to their grandparents, and that tradition is losing. And these stories, especially these stories, were peculiar with many characters from different categories. There were animals, there were supernatural beings, there were many other characters in all these stories. Usually in our younger age also, we used to listen to stories from our grandparents. But the younger generation is not able to listen to stories like this because both the older generation and younger generation have diverted from to different areas. Now, mostly in the evenings, the grandparents will be telling stories to the younger generation in the rural areas. But now the parents or the older ones are busy with their mega serials. They will be in front of their TVs, or they will be discussing all the matters, which are the programs in the TV, or they'll be having their mobile phones. Because even in rural areas, especially in Kerala rural areas, we have network connectivity in most of the areas, and they'll be busy with that. Like that, this younger generation, the kids are not ready to listen to all these things because they have all the benefits of technology and they will be busy with their studies or with the fun and frolic of the mobile phones. So all these things are detailed in the poem by Temslawo. She tells that we have to listen to all these stories. When we lose these stories, we are losing ourselves. We are not realizing our own identity. And this will be a great danger because as an Indian, we have to be very much careful about the cultural colonization, because we were the colony of the British powers for 200 years, more than 200 years. And now there is cultural colonization because of the loss of tradition, because of the losing of all these values, ethics, which is very much pertinent in Indian society. So Temslawo wants the younger generation that if you leave the tradition of storytelling or the orality, and if you are going towards the anthropocentric attitude, that is human-centric accurate writing. In that writing, it tells little stories which is related to the nature or the relationship between men and nature, or men and animals, or the supernatural things. all are marketized now. It is only profit oriented. Novels are written based on all these things, but the motive is profit making, fame and glory. But all these stories which were passed from generation to generation were not aimed at this profit making enterprise. So because of this writing centric process of education or bookish knowledge, we are losing our own culture as an Indian, or especially as Temsilava is from Northeast, which is rich in variety of cultures and traditions, rituals and practices, religious practices. And these generations, she is afraid that we will be losing our traditions, cultures, and all these values and ethics only because we are detaching ourselves from the oral tradition. So this poem is actually a reminder or a warning to the younger generation regarding the disappearance of oral tradition. And she exhorts the younger generation that there are this much of valuable information, treasures hidden inside these traditions. So if you lose the tradition, you are losing your own identity, your own culture, your own ethics, and your own values. So this is a reminder for the younger generation and a warning for the younger generation. And this poem is very much pertinent in this time of our generation, where both the younger and older generation are detaching from our tradition and culture, and they are behind technology to have fun and frolic. Thank you. That's all. I think I can wind up. Sir.
Okay. Thank you, Samir, Safir.
Yep.
Actually, I have one suggestion, not only for you and others also. Whenever you are going to present a paper in a research-based doctoral thesis conference, means it is your duty to concentrate on how and why instead of what. Okay. So what is your research objectives? What is your research questions and what type of methods you are in English? I'm not fully aware of the method you are using in general content analysis. So your review, systematic review, I think English language teachers or scholars are using. So that is important, because how you are maybe a systematic review also, what type of data you are collecting, whether primary data or secondary data, through even English language teachers attended yesterday also, I told even 2013, I attended one program on cultural memory organized by IFLU Shillong campus. So still in our culture, in our India, not only in India, all over the globe, culture is always dynamic, and there is no such type of culture only fixed to script or oral. It is all combination always. Even many things we are oral transformation only, we are informing, and cultural transformation is also. Suppose when you death ceremony or birth ceremony, these things never written, but all are practicing. Best example is the religious practices of our coordinator, Dr. Swatosini Gogoi from Ahom. So many things are there. Okay, anyhow, but in future, all other research scholars also, this is systematic, because research itself is a systematic process. It is our duty. This is my title of the PhD thesis topic. And my objectives are these, my research questions are these, my methodology like this. I am at this stage, I am doing a review of literature. I'm collecting data or systematic review literature. If you present like this, that is very good. Okay, now over to the participants. If you have, now I'm allowing the participant to interact. Anyone, please. Other research scholars, you can ask. Yeah, please.
Hello, teachers. I'm Pramita Saha. Sir, I just want to ask, sir, regarding, as sir has mentioned, we are not aware of those culture or the stories behind anything. So like, how to preserve those stories, sir?
Okay, taking the example of Kerala, we are in the government basis itself, we have a folklore society, and the government, we have Sahitya Academy and Folklore Academy, and the government is giving much encouragement for collecting all this folk literature, oral tradition. The stories are recorded and printed, and it is stored based on the recommendations of the government. There are specific bodies for that, and the main duty of the society is to create more occasions, ceremonies, festivals which are lying deep in our memories. There is try for or a movement or a approach towards this traditional rituals, ceremonies and customs to revive and to make it happen in our society. Just 5 years back, the Kerala government was conducting a folklore festival, and there the artists, the storytellers, the singers, folk singers were able to present their deliberations there. The younger generation who are interested in all these matters, there was a huge number of people who gathered in that compound. It is just 1 hour travel from my area, that is called Thrissur. Thrissur is called the cultural capital of Kerala. So there are many occasions, many attempts by both by the government and by many NGOs, many groups. And these groups are utilizing the benefit of the social media to revive all those traditions which were died to the memory. So this reviving is very important to keep our culture, tradition, and to revive all those stories which we are able to forget from our memories. So this is happening in Kerala. That is the Kerala picture. I don't know what about the government have to take initiative, and the society will be following that when there is a politically aware society. There is a politically aware society to accept all these things. Many students are interested in all these folklore, all these stories, and they are encouraging in their social media platforms also.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, that is true. Parvita Saha, actually, see, from Meghalaya only, Thura campus, you know better than others how cultural transformation is a cultural memory. Now the folklore and other international, not only the local departments of the organizations, the British libraries are recently, even Stephen Morey, we invited him on October 5th and 6th, the two-day international work conference in collaboration with the Chiang Mai Rajbhat University. Ma'am Srutasuni Gogoi, ma'am, visited personally and met him abroad. Stephen Morey, what he did, with the help of British Library, he digitalized all the scripts of a home. You know, because you are a Bengali. So in the Assamese and home culture, they digitalized, everything is available. Even myself and ma'am, we presented this paper, and recently it was going to publish in Myanmar. So here, based on the need and necessity and importance, because certain cultural memory be more valuable, and it is better to take care of the both. Right now, the government of India is also giving more importance. Even crores of funding is there. I think awareness is lagging, but in Sri Venkateswara University also, we have linguistics and foreign language department, but folklore is not here. But in almost northeastern states, anthropology. So not only, it's not belongs only to language department, many other departments are also working. It is our asset. Actually, it is our duty to protect whatever is also one type of wealth. Right now, more than 7,000 languages in the globe, but every year, some are one or two or more than even two-digit languages are also dying languages, least dangerous languages, just like plants. in Andaman Nicobar Island a few years back, the last person died, so one language ended. We are working, we are learning many things, but we are not in a position to create one's new world. But how a language development is a long process. I think proud to one way British Council and Commonwealth of Learning, they're increasing, motivating the others to learn English. At the same time, they're motivating other languages also. Because of English, sometimes it is a stepping stones for success, just a boon. Some other time it is not allowing other language for progress. But any language is language. The main purpose of language is communication, common language, common purpose. Based on time, based on purpose, based on need, it changes because it is a dynamic process. So maybe you are negligence or it's okay, but it's always dynamic. People are not in a, even government of Andhra Pradesh already decided and introduced English language in the government schools. Telangana government is also. So in the one time, maybe we get only one language, Telugu, only one subject. I studied my Telugu up to class 10, all Telugu medium only. So this is very, very important topic, but now digitalization is the best solution for all recording. Even if you go to Paramita Saha, to Guwahati University, Bhupen Hazarika, all the lyrics are available in the Guwahati University website. So nowadays very easy to record. So even with mobile itself, we have cloud storage. Simply any research scholar, if you are doing research on this topic, take their permission, may I record. So record it, if need, you can transfer it to other language, translation. So many things are there. Any other?
And in Kerala also we have a university, sir, that is called Malayalam University. And there are many departments for cultural enrichment.
Yeah, so yeah, this is taking place. Actually, the present government is giving extraordinary importance.
Yes.
CAL, Center for Indian Languages, at the same time, some more institution they are going to establish. Nowhere in this world we can find a country like India, multilingual, multicultural, very difficult. Within Kerala itself, you have Malabar, maybe one type of culture. So very even our Andhra, within district itself, different type of culture. So we are very near to Tamil Nadu. So that's why here Tamil culture is more, even though we are in Andhra Pradesh, we follow maximum the things, festivals, everything based on this region. We celebrate both our Telugu festivals and Tamil festivals. Any other? Okay, now thank you, Safir, but please, if you present, you have good communication skills, just like a first presenter, but if you have a PPT, it may be very good and you can reach maximum.
So yeah, yourself, next time I will try.
Okay, good. Now, Prasanna Kumar, over to you. Prasanna Kumar did his integrated BA and MA from IIT Kanpur. Now he's doing a PhD, already working a lecturer. Over to Prasanna Kumar. Now you are a presenter also. If you have PPT, you can make a present.
Can you see my screen, sir?
Yes, yes, yes. I think it is in PDF form, no?
Yes, sir. You want it into PPT form?
No, no, no. It's okay. Please move forward.
Okay. So, good morning to everyone. My name is Prasanna Kumar. I'm a research scholar working under the guidance of Dr. Radhika Madam, Associate Professor of Economics in Sri Venkateshwara University. So, today's topic for my research proposal seminar is Rural Unemployment, a Case Study in Chittoor District of Andhra Pradesh. So, before getting into the details of my research proposal seminar, let me introduce some of the concepts which need to be understood before entering into the research proposal. So, what is unemployment and how do we measure unemployment and what constitutes the labor force? These concepts need to be understood. So unemployment is a condition where a person is willing to work but is unable to find the work. He is ready to do a job. He is actively searching for a job, but he can't find a job. So that situation, that condition is called unemployment. And unemployment is measured by unemployment rate. So unemployment rate is calculated as number of unemployed persons divided by total labor force in a particular region. Let's say if you want to calculate for a whole India, then we should take total labor force exists in the country. If you want to calculate for a state, so we have to consider the total labor force exists in that state. Similarly, if you want to measure the unemployment rate in district, we should consider the labor force in the particular district. So what constitutes labor force? So the labor force is defined as the number of employed persons as well as unemployed persons who are actively searching for a job. So it includes both employed persons and unemployed persons who are actively searching for the job, but not unemployed people who are not willing to find a job. So as per 2011 India's census, out of 121 crores, 31.16% lives in urban areas and 68.84% lives in rural areas. So nearly 70% of our India's population still resides in the rural areas. So if we consider Andhra Pradesh state, out of 5 crore people of Andhra Pradesh, 29.6% is the urban population and 70.4% is the rural population. So what is the need to study this topic or this, what is the need to study this research or explore this research? So rural unemployment is a long-standing problem in our economy. So it's a chronic disease. So rural unemployment is of two types. The first type is seasonal unemployment. So seasonal unemployment is a condition where the agricultural laborers are employed only in a particular seasons. Now let's say, so before starting cultivation, you need to sow the seeds, you need to till the land. So for that, you require more laborers. So only in that particular season, more laborers are required, more laborers are employed. And also, once the crop matures, once it gets to harvest, then you employ more laborers. So in a particular year, agricultural laborers will not have entire employment throughout an year. So they will have only employment in a particular seasons. So that is called seasonal unemployment. So rest of the agricultural peak seasons, the agricultural laborers will be unemployed. Now, other type of rural unemployment is disguised unemployment. So disguised unemployment is a situation where the marginal productivity of the labor is zero. So what it means? So let me explain with an example. So let's say a family consists of 10 members. So in a village, a piece of work can be done by 4 to 5 members. So in that family, the rest 5 members also will participate in that particular work, because the rest 5 members are unemployed and they can't find job anywhere else. So instead of sitting idle in a house, so you are just participating in that particular work, but your contribution, but your marginal productivity is zero. So this type of situation you can see, we can predominantly find in agriculture sector and in rural areas. Now, so, and also due to the lockdowns induced by COVID pandemic, so we can see the unemployment touched peaks during the time of lockdowns. So this figure I took from Center for Monitoring Indian Economy website. So the first wave COVID pandemic lockdown was started in around March. So by the time of May 15th, 2020, so India's unemployment rate reached to 24.16%. Out of that, so the urban population is 26%, rural unemployment rate is 23.36%. So after this lockdown curbs were lifted, the economy was reviving again. So recently in the October, we have a unemployment rate of 7.74%. So out of that, urban unemployment rate is this unemployment rate increased more due to rural unemployment, even though the non-farm jobs in the, and also urban employment was increasing, but rural employment was not picking up. So rural unemployment leads to poverty among the rural households, and also in turn it leads to the reduction in the standard of living. So unemployment creates distress among the rural households, depression among the rural households. So it may lead to increase in the crime rates, it may lead to suicides. So it creates many socio-economic crises. So rural unemployment problems need to be addressed by the government proactively by taking immediate measures. So to prevent this socio-economic crisis emerging from the rural unemployment, I'm studying this research. I'm exploring this research. So my objectives are to measure the rural unemployment and causes of the rural unemployment in the Chittoor district. So usually, if you review the literature, we can find because of rapid population growth, limited land, fragmentation of the land, lack of transportation facilities, lack of proper educational facilities, decline of cottage industries. These are the main reasons for the rural unemployment. And then I will examine the rural impact of rural unemployment on rural households. So what is the impact on the poverty? What is the impact on their incomes? What is the impact on their expenditure? What is the impact on their savings? And also I will study the socioeconomic conditions of sample rural households in Chittoor district. And by evaluating, by measuring the rural unemployment, I will try to suggest the policies which can reduce the rural unemployment among the sample rural households. So my hypotheses are unemployment in sample rural households is insignificant. And my alternative hypothesis for the null hypothesis is unemployment in sample rural households is significant. And my second null hypothesis is unemployment has no significant impact on poverty levels of rural households. The other alternative hypothesis is unemployment has significant impact on poverty levels of rural households. And third null hypothesis is whether COVID pandemic has any significant impact on rural unemployment. So my null hypothesis is COVID pandemic has no significant impact on rural unemployment. And alternative hypothesis is it has significant impact on rural unemployment. So my research methodology is, so first coming to the collection of samples, so we need to have a systematic way of collection of data. So for that, I will be using multi-stage stratified random sampling method, which will reduce the sampling error to draw the samples from the rural households. So in the first stage, so because I chose Chittoor district, so Chittoor district has three revenue divisions. They are Chittoor, Madanapalli and Tirupati. And from these three revenue divisions, I will select two revenue mandals in the second stage. Out of these two mandals, I will be selecting two villages randomly. And then in the fourth stage, from each village, I will be collecting 20 samples from the rural households. So this is the study area and location. So Chittoor district consists of three revenue divisions. They are Tirupati, Chittoor and Madanapalli. And the name of the selected mandals are, in the Tirupati revenue division, I will be selecting Renigunta mandal, Satyavedu mandal. And from these two mandals, four villages will be selected and 80 samples will be collected from this revenue division. Similarly, from Chittoor, I will be collecting 80 samples from Puttur and Vadamalpeta mandals, from Madanapalli, Punganur and Madanapalli mandals. From these two mandals, 80 samples will be collected. So overall 240 samples will be collected. So my sample size is 240. Now, coming to data sources, so my research will be primarily dependent on primary data. So whenever I require, secondary data will be used from periodicals, from NSSO, National Sample Survey Organization, survey rounds, and other journals, etc. And the statistical tools like percentages, means, standard deviation, and to compare the means, I will be using t-test and also chi-square test wherever necessary. So for the quantitative analysis of my data, I will be using statistical package for software, social sciences. And the limitations are, the study is confined only to the sample mandals of Chittoor districts, and this can't be generalized for other districts. So this is the chapter design. In the first chapter, I will be writing introduction, and the second chapter, review of literature and research methodology. And in the third chapter, an overview of, I will do a comparative overview of rural unemployment exists in India, in the Andhra Pradesh and in Chittoor district. In the fourth chapter, I will be writing a profile of the Chittoor district. Fifth chapter, socioeconomic conditions of the sample residents. So sixth chapter, problems faced by the sample residents, what are the causes and other things. And in the seventh chapter, I will be doing a summary of the findings and any suggestions if I found. And these are the my references. And I prepared a sample schedule where I will be collecting the identification data. In the identification data, what is their name, age, sex, whether they are married, so what is their family type, whether they are below poverty line, above poverty line, whether they have a pakka house, semi kacha house, and their land holdings, their educational status, whether they are literate, illiterate, up to which standard they studied, whether they studied up to intermediate, graduation, post graduation. So what are the reasons for leaving the school, and how easily they are accessible, how employment schemes are accessible to them. So what is the wage rate under Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Act, how many number of work days they were appointed, whether they are paid any commission to get their wages, and current employment status. So in the some other qualitative data that if they are employed in for seasons, from which month to from which month they were employed, and whether during the time of corona whether they were employed or unemployed. So, and then their expenditure status, their saving status, and what are the sources of their loan, from which sources they are getting this loan, from money lenders or banks, from others, and what is the mobile penetration and internet penetration into the rural households, how many own the mobile phones, how many own the internet connection in their mobiles, whether they know about unified payment interface like Google Pay or Phone Pay. So, and also I will also consider the gender aspects, like females, how difficult for a female to get a job, whether she is suffering any harassment in the workplace, is there any family pressure to quit a job. So this is my research proposal seminar. I am in the stage of review of literature. So thank you. If any participant find any mistakes and suggestions, please let me know. I will try to improve it and I will incorporate in my research. Thank you, sir. Thank you for giving me this opportunity.
Good, Prasanna Kumar. Now over to the participants first. Before giving my feedback, I will ask the participants to give your provide your feedback. Anyone, please. We'll finish our program at one itself. No problem. I don't take more time. And they will get your certificate. Yeah, please.
Hello, sir.
Yeah, please.
This is sir. Yes, sir. So I wanted to find out if maybe he can find a particular gap that he is filling, because I believe that issues of unemployment might have been done many times in the literature. So if maybe he can at least get a gap that he is on to this study. So is there any gap that he's filling?
Okay. So actually, Prasanna Kumar, Opeku Adusi is from Ghana. Then international scholar, so he's asking, in general, many studies are doing on unemployment because it is a burning problem. So have you found any through your review of literature, what you got through it?
Yeah, I took this particular district because I am working in this district, and also at the rural areas, the many are unemployed. So by looking at the condition, I took these topics. I didn't find any gap, I guess, but I want to research. See, research is all about searching again, right? I don't know whether it's correct, but please correct me.
It's okay. Actually, because of new innovations and the special economic zones, so much new job opportunities are coming up, and people are getting new jobs and they're losing some existing jobs. Even in America, lakhs of people are putting their resignation because they need a new job, whatever salaries, whatever they are getting right now, they are not happy with it. So there are so many reasons are there that is different. Okay, any other?
Sir, I would like to ask one question.
Yeah, please.
Sir, with respect to your thesis, is there any relationship between gender, like males and female unemployment percentage, sir?
Actually, madam, he just started review of literature only. They prepared the proposal and are doing review of literature. till date they are not in a position to go for the field. So after maybe collecting data only, they can, based on review of literature, you can give answer, Prasanna Kumar.
Usually, you see the whenever a job losses happens in the rural area, the most affected are the women, because they are only not educated, and also they are confined to their family pressures and also confined to their villages. So if any job loss happens, the worst sufferers are women, ma'am. And because usually this rural unemployment affects females more than men. Men can have a mobility because they can at least go to some beside towns, or they can migrate to some other places. But for a woman, it is not so easy to move. The mobility is not very easy for a woman.
So another problem in India, actually, this is not good to say like that. When March 8th, few years back, we celebrated in Northeastern Hill University International Women Day. One of the students showed the play card, "I never married a home, don't never call me a housewife. I never married a house, don't call me a housewife." Here, being a housewife means, that's why I'm always calling a home minister. So even though a woman, married woman at home, but she can do work more than the life partner and others, but according our policies are never treating it as a employment. Whenever you are getting any income, that is only, so the definition of, there is a need of the hour to change the definition of unemployment also. Suppose my sister is there, she PhD in economics only, she is taking care of the family. So the work she is doing more than the others, those who are working women. So this type of things are also there. That's why some women, they are always asking, why you are calling me a housewife? Don't call me a housewife. And they suggested researchers to add the housewife also a profession.
Homemaker.
Yes, homemaker, we can say right words. So here you used the study area location and your sample four villages is stratified. Maybe within this stratified random sampling technique, you are going to adapt.
Yes, sir.
Otherwise, okay. Another thing, just to go to your schedule, whenever you are making your schedule, it is better. Suppose whenever you are using income, please put rupees symbol for in front of the number. And gender, according to UGC, it is better to use a transgender or along with not only male and female, even neutral also you can. Another thing, here whenever this one, you are going to take both educated and uneducated, na?
Yes, sir. Yes.
In that cases, you can't, maybe an interview schedule means this one is a perfectly a structured interview.
Yes, sir.
Structured interview schedule. You are going to interview only, na?
Yes, sir.
If you are uneducated, you can't, if you issue the, they can't fill it. Okay, in that cases, what you can do, you can use the brackets to simply put the tick mark. Otherwise, then the top also, it's okay. So another thing, somewhere you are using just to come down, open-ended questions, if yes, if no. Please don't make this into two statements. Just go to down, I tell you. See, here you made nicely, sixth statement you've done nicely. If employed, okay, just go to fifth statement. See here. DEE126, okay, see. You started, if employed currently, means the sequence. Otherwise, I will take here. 11th, you did rightly. Are you willing to take any kind of job? Yes or no, if yes. But what you done, just go next after 15. Yes, see here. Have you ever taken loan? Yes or no? If yes, please, this type of, suppose if the same page, it's okay. If a different page, now, maybe it, in general, any statement in your schedule, it not good to start with F. It is always better within the fifth statement itself. Have you ever taken the loan? Because it's a continuity of the same statement. Please put this if yes. Those who are ticking or giving answer yes, for them only you are going for further. Remainings, no need. If that type of, suppose I selected no. So what I can do with the sixth statement? So I don't want to select anything. That is why, to avoid this type of problems, now you can make, suppose you are entering the data. There are 25 statements are there, only 15 or 17 they given response. Remaining means they are actually not supposed to give. Here if I select no, I am not able to give a response to 6. So if you put the same statement, you can avoid all these things. Better whenever you are using the open and close open-ended questions, use the same statement. Next.
So, thank you.
Next. Here also, if female, wherever it is, please go through it like that.
Okay.
Some Jaichitra, what type of organization was chosen for the study? She's asking. Here, I think they are not selected any organization. They are selected villages. Nah?
Yes, sir. Villages.
Within village, actually, they identified based on sampling random technique because village sarpanch is there. Here, the village sarpanch or secretary, they have all the data of the villagers, what type of age group, people, gender are there. So based on that, they can, while using any lottery system or other type of random sampling techniques, they can select. Here, not organization, he's a household. Next. Any other? Right. Thank you. So you are not using any research questions in your proposal, only objectives and hypothesis.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Actually, different. Here, you see one more thing. Just little bit above. Yeah. Little bit above. Okay. Whenever you are using more than one hypothesis, better hypothesis, SES, that is plural.
Okay.
Next. Population, do you have any population? In our education research, we are always giving population and sample. So that is our criteria. So it is interdisciplinary and no need to follow the same. Whatever your department, maybe every department also within the discipline, they have their own way of research. Only thing, you need to follow the systematic. That's all. Okay, thank you for your nice presentation. Now I will move for
thank you, sir. Thank you for all your suggestions and other ma'am's questions. Thank you.
Welcome, Prasanna Kumar. For all paper presenters, I will issue the certificate today, and even participants also, 8 p.m. onwards. Maybe yesterday it took almost 9:30 like that. Yesterday also I issued the paper presenter certificates. Today also I will issue all immediately without any pain. Now just I will take only 5 to 7 minutes, not like yesterday. Just this is a there are two objectives of the my paper only, so I will share what is it. To motivate our scholars, because nowadays in the COVID-19 pandemic, it is our duty to utilize more ICT. So ICT integrated research methodology, innovative approaches. This is myself and Dr. Sutasni Gogoi Madam and Chennai sir. So here the objectives of the paper is to motivate the scholars for effective utilization of ICT tools in educational research, to familiarize the list of ICT tools in educational research. And here different approaches. My best approach is MOASU open online courses through MOOC courses. I always like to start with this quotation. If you wish to plant for a year, sow seeds. If you wish to plant for 10 years, plant a tree. And if you wish to plant for lifetime, develop a man. That development is through education. Here, to 7th century BC, very nice. So ICT, everyone is familiar with ICT, information and communication technology. Components of ICT, the term information and communication technology is generally accepted to mean all technologies that combine, allow people and organization to interact in the digital world. Just I want to share here, recall when I was MA philosophy student in Sri Venkateswara University 2009 and 11. So after my PhD, I did. So one of students, his name is MGR. So he put his, what is MGR? In Tamil, former superstar hero, former Chief Minister M.G. Ramachandran. But his name is MGR only. Sir asked Professor Uma Shankar, what is the full form of MGR? He said, no, sir, my name is MGR only. My God. Then the first time in my life, I got the type of experience I never felt. So the name itself is a recognition, but in the same way, whenever someone, maybe we are familiar with the TV only, not a television, but ICT, but in research, some of experts, they ask you give full form instead of ICT, right? So this is my, in the 2018, I delivered lecture on the, at Savitribai Phule Pune University for refresher online ARPIT course with the help of Dr. Shrotasni Gogoi ma'am. This is an excellent model after doing four MOOC courses on learning online, how to search content. I did four courses, search, select, study, skillful, store, and share here. Specific, excellent, applicable, reliable, and creative, helpful content. Here, supreme, master, approachable, reachable, and transferable. Actually, how to search content. Maybe here, why I selected this one. Anything you are going to select your topic, search, you are always doing search. In research, search is an integral part, search and search research. This is actually research different. Some of our researchers, they mentioned 5 steps, 6 steps, 7 steps, up to 11 steps. Your first step is a problem, purpose, identification of research area. Even Professor Sudarshan sir also told, identification of your research area and research problem is the first step. Is there any ICT tool? You have many, N number, 15 types of even search engines are there, websites are there, and extraordinary tools and techniques. Hypothesis or questions, literature review here, conceptual framework, study design, sampling here, instruments, legal, ethical. Professor Sudarshan sir already informed about ethical. Data collection, how you can collect data. Now online, everything is for a review of literature also. We have Mendeley, RefMe, RefSeq, online tools you can use for data collection, Google Forms, SurveyMonkey, many online tools, data analysis for quantitative data, qualitative data, discussion, summary, and references also. We have again, many Mendeley, these things are the same review of literature purpose. Reference purpose also you can, and the budget and for funding, same qualitative research methods here, direct, the first one in-depth interview, structured, unstructured, and semi-structured, literature review, systematic literature review, we can use one type of method, participant observation, open-ended survey, sorry, focus groups and direct observation. This is a qualitative research process, identify phenomena of interest, phenomenology here, known background research question. That's why I asked the Prasanna Kumar research question. Not only in the qualitative, even quantitative, also mixed method, also philosophy here, foundation study design, sampling, legal ethical, pilot study. So to standardize the data, we need a pilot study. Otherwise, so data analysis, review of literature, findings, and limitations. So another here, this is a mix, both qualitative and quantitative. You can see the experimental correlation mixed method also, where you can, maybe these steps are common. Identify research problem, you can use the ICT tools, searching, reviewing literature. We have a number of tools. purpose collecting data also. So every in report writing, we are support again ICT tools. Whether you can use your own MS Office and for graph purpose, graphing SPSS also. So where you can use and specific excellent here, applicable, reliable, creative and helpful. Whenever you are learn what to learn, it is your duty to question yourself 5W and 1H. I don't want to repeat again and again. The four pillars of here, learning to know, learning to do, learning to be, learning to live together. So thinking is very important for research scholar. Whenever you are doing any research, it is your duty to think differently, divergently. Yeah, different types of things. Abstract thinking, analytical thinking, artistic thinking, concrete thinking, convergent thinking, creative thinking, critical thinking, divergent thinking, holistic thinking, parallel thinking, reflective thinking, or logical thinking, and sequential thinking or rational thinking, 360 degree thinking. So tips, whenever you are searching, suppose I took this one, I'll delivering one lecture on environmental science of Nehu in 2018. So the environment I would selected, this one, see, within less than 1 second, 52 crores, 80 lakhs content. But I want to filter what I did. I used a double inverted quotation. I filtered almost 1 crore 40 lakhs content by using PDF. All maximum research reports are available in the PDF. Better after the keyword search, it is better to use a PDF. We will get all only 2 crore 53 lakhs. The same way DOC or DOCS or PPT, the combination of functions and or not. I want research, not publication. If you write research, not publication, research and publication, research or publication, everything. So teaching and learning, teaching or learning, teaching not learning. So if you use the combination of two, more than two functions also, now see how it is. I'm using here within inverted environment and pollution, 15 lakhs content only. Without inverted quotation, you can see here, 1 crore 7 lakhs. Where is 15 lakhs? Where is 1 crore? So you can identify whatever in general. I don't know here how many participants are using double inverted quotation while searching. If you use these tips, this is the first. So study, already I told this one is whenever you are doing. Professor Chennai sir rightly told to Santosh, and not only Santosh, all, it is our duty to give more maximum. Suppose you are trying something but you are not reaching, means you are not putting maximum efforts, you are not allotting your maximum time. Why we are organizing on January 1st, 25th December, again 14th January, even though festivals of various religious. So it is our duty, is a continuous process, maximum effort, maximum interest, maximum time, everything. If you do, then only. I like the word in English, again and again, research here, search and research in the same way, recall, receive, recommend, reconcrete, reconfirm, everything is reuse, restate here, refinance, republish, republic, just we celebrated yesterday. So what do you mean by study? This is also a research definition. Systematic research. Study itself is a systematic research. Examination, identification, and understanding of the aspects of factor associated with an activity, event, phenomena, situation, etc. So many things are there in studying. But according to the again the theories, if you read, reading, if you remember only 10% after 2 weeks. So it is better to do activities. Skimming and scanning here. Techniques that maybe the Safir, the language teachers, you are using always the skimming and scanning techniques is very important. Skimming is a reading rapidly in order to get a general overview. Scanning is a reading rapidly in order to find a specific. A researcher, you need this skimming and scanning techniques. British Council is a reflective journal. Whenever, see, always I'm keeping one book and pen with me. Always, whenever something is always, I'm noting down. If this is we are calling reflective down. These are digital tools are also there. Not only offline, even online, one book is there. So you can use this, no need to inform this one. So skill, what a research scholar you need a research skills. Forget about other skills. First, you need research skills. That's why we moved from research capabilities also. Already we organized some programs. Digital India, so many digital initiatives are, these are all our digital tools. Swayam Prabha for EID, Shodh Ganga is a reservoir of Indian PhD thesis, National Academic Depository, even Institutional Repository, even here, National Digital NDL, we are simply calling ODCAT, WORLD, ODCAT is more than 10,000 libraries you can visit the single click. So many, these are all our, text transcription of video content, SOS tools, EPG Pathashala, NASDAQ also, SOL 2.0, UGC MOOCs, everything is digital initiatives. What you can do? So ICT tools and researchers, suppose your Gmail is only 15 GB. So now my Gmail, normal Gmail, I have more than 44 GB. So what I did, I purchased 100 GB cloud storage from Google. I'm paying annually. So, but what you can do for research purpose, you can create one more email ID and all the information, whatever you have, instead of sending mail, store in your Google Drive. That's why store and share very easily. Suppose I provided all 823 research methodology books through my, stored in my Google Drive, shared through my blog. This is share. I have my own blog already, you know, and it is hamsareddy.blogspot.com. Even someone, they have their own websites, apps, WhatsApp, but WhatsApp, some advantages and disadvantages, different things, social networks. Smart, this is a supreme master, approachable, reachable, and transferable. So some of people are always texting already. I said after national anthem only, we shared the feedback form. So just a recapitulation, plan, teach, feedback, recapitulation. This is a research writing, how to do a literature review, an extraordinary course from University of Wollongong. Through this course only, I got 14 types of review of literature. Through this only, I got a Mendeley, RefMe, RefSeq, EndNote, so many online tools, digital tools, even plagiarism tools also. So it is better always go through it. I will one by one. Those who are interested, you can join February 14th to 23rd. We are organizing a 10-day workshop on developing your research project. Under this, we will share. So this one is a systematic literature review, another MOOC course from Coventry University, UK. This is a community-based research getting started. This one, see, American University of here, Beirut, and LAUCLS here, University of College London. This is why ethics matter. Ethics is also very, very important. Research, academic integrity and research ethics. So this one is a Deakin University, Griffith University, extraordinary course. This one also, why number matter, why matter research, qualitative, quantitative. So delivering research data management services. This one also, Edinburgh, University of Edinburgh. Discovering your PhD potential. Now all the three presenters are there doing their PhD. This is very useful for you, discovering your PhD potential, writing a research proposal. I did this course in the year 2017 from University of Leicester. Here, career management for early career academic researchers. For early career academic researchers, maybe research scholars are also University of Sheffield and University of Glasgow, University of Edinburgh, extraordinary. One more, why numbers matter. Someone is want to do quantitative. Maybe now the Prasanna Kumar told mine is a quantitative study. Actually, to say frankly, there is no such type of 100% quantitative, 100% qualitative. In general, we are using both, but now the mixed method, that is a different concept. Sometimes we are expressing quality also in terms of quantity, how many students are excellent in your class. So you can say there are 40% of the students are two students are excellent. So number is and quality. So education research that matters, ways of researching. This is also University of Birmingham and Chartered College of Teaching. There are three courses under education research. Education research that matters, applying research to your teaching practice. One more same from Coventry University, academic research methodology for master degree students. Research impact making a difference. This is very University of Glasgow. One more here, introduction to research ethics, working with people. why planning your research matters. Here, Deakin University and GIFI the same. How to write a PhD research proposal. This one is also very good, but here I think all the research scholars already uploaded their proposal. Why experience matters? This is a qualitative research. Same, GIFI and Deakin University. Learning online, searching and researching. This is I told about. Based on this course only, I myself and with the help of Satoshi Madam, we invented this 7S model. Learning online, researching your project. So why research matter? Again, same. So introduction to research ethics, working with people, academic integrity, values, skills, and action. This is also very, very important. University of Auckland here. So New Zealand, even I did it from Australia. Developing your research project, University of Southampton, this is UK. This is action research from NCRT. This is Commonwealth of Learning, OER, Open Educational Resources. This is actually just only 2 minutes. ICT Tool Index. This one, very nice presentation while preparing for your presentation. I just got it. Even SPSS, I'm from mass background. I'm using SPSS. I'm taking classes at various platforms. So this one, if you just open, you will get extraordinary material. Almost more than 50 slides are there. So just go through it. I will share this one through my blog today. I will do, don't worry, because afternoon I'm free only. So many participants are sharing. This is wonderful, almost 40 C. Yeah, Roy University, they did, because someone that are doing it is better to give credit to them instead of this is not mine, this is there. Already they put all the tools, but this is actually the science, 100% science. So this one is also very good list of ICT tools and A to Z. You are getting what type of tools are there. Even one by one, we will take care in every doctoral thesis conference and Friday, every Friday we are organizing a international workshop, research and publication. There we are using, I can. So application of ICT here, you can see at each level then very nicely. I have the same idea, but already is available. That's why I'm taking the same instead of doing by myself. Application of ICT in pre-data analysis, how you can use here, literature search, content search, literature tracking, data collection. So I have also, that's why I told the research process, how. So here, these are all some of famous database research article literature. These are all AMS, annual reviews, Cambridge. I told about CORE, Cambridge CORE, UK, USA, Oxford, UK. But CORE is from UK, one project is also there. Last time I mentioned here, just one of my article is here, the project, many things, see? And content search, literature tracking, here Mendeley, I told about Mendeley here, data collection. So here SurveyMonkey, Google Form, application, quantitative data analysis, qualitative data analysis, application of ICT, post data analysis, references, bibliography. Instead of typing by yourself, please use these reference tools to give EndNote. I told already EndNote, Jotiro, Mendeley, article thesis. So plagiarism also, we have different. Some of participants long back, they asked along with, please tell me. So this is my duty to Grammarly, article checker. Here, Turnitin and duplicate checker, etc. Journal manuscript elsewhere, it is better under Scopus. Villay, they are also while organizing so many programs. This is Sage, Springer Nature. So everything, please go through it. So this is about 5Ls model. Already I have one more. So this is about ICT. Just before concluding, I have one more thing to share. Always I like to, this is a srogguide.net, A to Z digital tools are available in the single website. And this is a srogguide.net, web 2.0 tools, all the ICT tools, A to Z in the single website. This is the only, you can go through it, everything is available here. Survey feedback, you can use all for research here. And online mapping tools, online time maker, citations, these are all citations. Now APS 7th we are using. So at the end, before this is education technology periodic table. So this is about So I will take some other time. I don't know why the participants are typing feedback. I am available always for you. If you really miss, you can do. Please, Ved Prakash, Dr. Feedback link, please. If you do it, always distracts. Okay, no problem. Just I'm going for without any question and answer because of your text, national anthem and feedback. Participant, please, I am unmuting all. I muted all.
Janagana mana adhinayaka jaya hai Bharat bhagya vidhata Punjab, Sindh, Gujarat, Maratha, Dravida, Utkala, Vanga, Vindhya, Himachala, Yamuna, Ganga, Uchala, Jaladhi, Taranga, Tava Shubha Name Jage, Tava Shubha Ashish Mage, Gahe Tava Jaya Gatha, Jana Gana Mangala Dayaka Jaya He Bharat Bhagya Vidhata Jaya He Jaya He Jaya He Jaya 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 He
Jai Hind, thank you. Yes, I'm sharing a feedback form. Please fill, but you will get your certificate after 8 p.m. only, after checking your attendance through Cisco Webex and YouTube. I will share. Just I'm sharing the feedback form. Once you submit and check your confirmation mail, once you get your confirmation mail, then you can leave the meeting. So tomorrow at 2 o'clock we can. YouTube viewers also, please, you can submit. Yeah, please. Messages. Error is in it. Now it is opening for me. Please open it. Varan means for you, maybe. Please check. It is opening for me. Yeah, YouTube viewers, please just check. I shared with you also. Yeah, already submitted many, more than 20 submitted. Now I'm stopping the YouTube live link. Please submit and leave. You'll get your certificate after 8 p.m. today. Thank you.